Colonization, Second Contact by Harry Turtledove. Narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Copyright 1999 by Harry Turtledove. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Harry Turtledove and the Scoville Galen Gosh Literary Agency, Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2010 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. 1. Atvar, the commander of the race's conquest fleet, poked a control with a finger claw. A holographic image sprang into being above the projector in the Fleet Lord's office. In the 40 years since the conquest fleet came to Tosev III, half that many local years, he had grown all too intimately familiar with that particular image. So had Kirill, shiplord of the 127th Emperor Hetto, the banner ship of the conquest fleet. The body paint on his scaly, green-brown hide was more ornate than every other male's, save only Atvar's. His mouth fell open in amusement, revealing a great many small, sharp teeth. A slight waggle to his lower jaw gave his laughter a sardonic twist. "Once more we behold the mighty Tosevite warrior, exalted fleet lord," he said. He ended the sentence with an interrogative cough. "Even so, shiplord," Atvar answered. "Even so. He does not look as if he would cause us much trouble, does he?" "By the Emperor, no," Kirill said. Both Atvar and he swiveled their turreted eyes so they looked down at the ground for a moment. A gesture of respect for the sovereign back on distant home. As Atvar had done so many times before, he walked around the hologram to view it from all sides. The Tosevite male was mounted on a hairy local quadruped. He wore a tunic of rather rusty chain armor, and over it a light cloth coat. A pointed iron helmet protected his brain case. Tufts of yellowish hair grew like dry grass on his scaleless, pinkish cheeks and jaw. For armament, he had a spear, a sword, a knife, and a shield with a cross painted in red on it. A long, hissing sigh escaped Atvar.
"If only it had been as easy as we thought it would be." "Truth, exalted fleet lord," Kirill said. "Who would have thought the Big Uglies," the nickname the race used for its Tosevite subjects and neighbors, "could have changed so much in a mere 1600 years?"
"No one," Atvar said. "No one at all."
He used a different cough this time, one that emphasized the words preceding it. They deserved emphasis. The race, and the Halesi and Rabotevs, whose planets the Empire had ruled for thousands of years, changed only very slowly, only very cautiously. For the race, one millennium was like another. After sending a probe to Tosev III, everyone back on home had blithely assumed the barbarians would not have changed much by the time the conquest fleet arrived. Never in its 100,000 years of unified imperial history, and never in the chaotic times before, for that matter, had the race got a larger and more unpleasant surprise. When the conquest fleet did reach Tosev III, it found not sword-swinging savages, but a highly industrialized world with several empires and not-empires battling one another for dominance.
"Even after all these years, there are times when I still feel rage that we did not completely conquer this planet," Atvar said. "But on the other fork of the tongue, there are also times when I feel nothing but relief that we still maintain control over any part of its surface." "I understand, exalted fleet lord," Kirill said. I know you do, shiplord. I am glad you do,
Atvar said.
But I do wonder if anyone back on home truly understands. I have the dubious distinction of commanding the first interstellar conquest fleet in the history of the race that did not conquer completely. That is not how I intended hatchlings to remember me.
Conditions here were not as we anticipated them,
Kirill said loyally. He'd had his chances to be disloyal, had them and not taken them. By now, Atvar was willing to believe he wouldn't. He went on,
Do you not agree that there is a certain amount of irony in the profit we have made off the Tosavites by selling them this image and others from the probe? Their own scholars desire those photographs because they have none of their own from what seems to them to be a distant and uncivilized time.
Irony, yes, that is one of the words I might apply to the situation. One of the politer words,
Atvar said. He went back to his desk and prodded the control again. The Tosavite warrior vanished. He wished he could make all the Tosavites vanish that easily, but no such luck. He replaced the warrior's image with a map of the surface of Tosev III. By his standards, it was a chilly world, with too much water and not enough land. Of what land there was, the race did not rule enough. Only the southern half of the lesser continental mass, the southwest and south of the main continental mass, and the island continent to the southeast of the main continental mass were reassuringly red on the map. The knot empires of the Americans, the Ruskies, and the Deutsche all remained independent and needed colors of their own. So did the island empires of Britain and Nippon, though both of them were shrunken remnants of what they had been when the conquest fleet came to Tosev III. Kirill also turned one eye toward the map while keeping the other on Atvar.
Truly, exalted fleet lord, it could be worse.
So it could, Atvar said with another sigh. But it could also be a great deal better. It would be a great deal better if these areas here on the eastern part of the main continental mass, especially this one called China, acknowledged our rule as they should.
I have long since concluded that the big uglies never do things as they should,
Kirill said.
I agree completely,
the fleet lord replied. His little tail stump twitched in agitation.
But how are we to convince the fleet lord of the colonization fleet that this is the case?
Now Kirill sighed.
I do not know. He lacks our experience with this world. Once he acquires it, he will, I am sure, come round to our way of thinking. But we must expect him to be rigid for a time.
Back on home, rigid was a term of praise. It had been a term of praise when the conquest fleet came to Tosev III, too. No more. Males of the race who stayed too rigid stood not a chance of understanding the big uglies. By the standards of home, the males of the conquest fleet, those who still survived, had grown dreadfully flighty.
Males, Atvar said, it will be good to have females in range of the scent receptors on my tongue once more. When they come into season and I smell their pheromones, I will have an excuse for not thinking about this accursed world for a while. I look forward to having the excuse, you understand, not to the breeding itself.
Of course, exalted fleet lord,
Kirill said primly.
You are no big ugly to have such matters always on your mind.
I should hope not, Atvar exclaimed. Like any other member of the race, he viewed Tosavite sexuality with a sort of horrified fascination. Intellectually, he grasped how the Big Ugly's year-round interest in mating colored every aspect of their behavior. But he had no feel for the subtleties, or indeed for what the Big Uglies no doubt viewed as broad strokes. Despite intensive research, few males of the race did, any more than the Tosavites could understand the race's dispassionate view of such matters. Pishing, Atvar's adjutant, came into the chamber. One side of his body was painted in a pattern that matched the Fleet Lord's, the other showed his own far lower rank. He bent his forward-sloping torso into the posture of respect and waited to be noticed.
Speak, Atvar said. Give forth.
I thank you, exalted Fleet Lord, Pishing said. I beg leave to report that the lead ships of the Colonization Fleet have passed within the orbit of Tosev IV, the planet the Big Uglies call Mars. Very soon now, those ships will seek to circle and land on this world.
I am aware of this, yes.
Atvar's voice was even drier than the desert surrounding the riverside city, Cairo, the local name for it was, where he made his headquarters.
Is my distinguished colleague in the Colonization Fleet aware that the Tosavites, for all their protestations of peaceful intent, may seek to harm his ships when they do reach Tosev III?
Fleet Lord Refet continues to assure me that he is, Pishing replied. He was quite taken aback to receive radio transmissions from the various Tosavite not empires.
He should not have been, Atvar said. We have been warning him for some time of the Big Ugly's ever-increasing capacities.
Kirill said, Exalted Fleet Lord, he will have to learn by experience, as we also had to do. Let us hope his experience proves less painful than ours.
Indeed.
Atvar let out a worried hiss. His voice grew grim.
And let us hope all the Tosavites take seriously our warning to them that an attack on the Colonization Fleet by any of them will be construed as an attack by all of them, and that we shall do our utmost to punish all of them should any such attack occur.
I wish we had not had to issue such a warning,
Kirill said.
So do I, Atvar replied, but at least 4 and perhaps 5 of their realms possess missile-firing undersea ships. Who back on home would have dreamt of such things?
Oh, I understand the problem, Kirill said, but the general warning all but invites the Tosavites to combine against us and to reduce their conflicts among themselves.
Diplomacy.
Atvar made the word into a curse. Manuals on the subject, their data gleaned from the race's ancient history and early conquests, suggested playing the locals against one another. But to Atvar and his colleagues, such concerns were but theory, and musty theory at that. The Big Uglies, divided among themselves, were expert practitioners of the art. After a negotiating session with them, Atvar always wanted to count his fingers and toes to make sure he hadn't inadvertently traded them away.
Pishing said, When the colonists are revived from cold sleep, when they come down to Tosev III, we will begin to turn this into a proper world of the Empire.
I admire your confidence, Adjutant.
Kirill said. Pishing crouched respectfully. Kirill went on.
I wonder what the colonists will make of us. We are hardly proper males of the race ourselves anymore.
dealing with the Tosavites for so long has left us as addled as bad eggs.
We have changed,
Atvar agreed. Back on home, that would have been a curse. Not here, though he had taken a long time to realize it.
Had we not changed, our war with the big uglies would have wrecked this planet. And what would the colonization fleet have done then?
Not a single male on Tosev 3 had found an answer to that question. Atvar was sure Refet would have no answer for it either. But he was also sure the fleet lord of the colonization fleet would have questions of his own. Would he himself, would any male on Tosev 3, be able to find answers for them? The pitcher windmilled into his delivery. The runner took off from first base. The batter hit a sharp ground ball to short. The shortstop gobbled it up and fired it over to first. The softball slapped Sam Yeager's mitt, beating the runner to the bag by a step and a half. The umpire had hustled up from behind home plate. "You're out!" he yelled and threw his fist in the air. "That's the ball game," Yeager said happily. "Another win for the good guys." He tacked on an emphatic cough for good measure. "Nice game, Major," the pitcher said. "A homer and a double. I guess we'll take that." "Thanks, Eddie," Yeager said, chuckling. "I can still get around on a softball." He was in his mid-50s and in good shape for his mid-50s, but he couldn't hit a baseball for beans anymore. It irked him. He'd been in his 18th season of minor league ball when the Lizards came, and he'd kept playing as much and as long as he could after going into the Army. He rolled the softball toward the chicken wire dugout in back of first base. He'd been an outfielder when he played for money, but he couldn't cover the ground out there anymore either, so nowadays he played first. He could still catch and he could still throw. A couple of guys from the other team came over and shook his hand. They'd been playing just for the fun of playing. He'd had fun too. He wouldn't have put on spikes if he didn't have fun, but he'd gone out there to win. Playing for money for all those years had ingrained that in him. Up in the wooden bleachers behind the wire fence, Barbara clapped her hands along with the other wives and girlfriends. Sam doffed his cap and bowed. His wife made a face at him. That wasn't why he put the cap back on in a hurry, though. He was getting thin on top, and Southern California summer sunshine was no joke. He'd sunburned his scalp a couple of times, but he intended never, ever to do it again. "Head for Jose's!" Win or lose, that cry rang out after a game. Winning would make the tacos and beer even better. Sam and Barbara piled into their Buick and drove over to the restaurant. It was only a few blocks from the park. The Buick ran smoothly and quietly. Like more and more cars every year, it burned hydrogen, not gasoline, technology borrowed from the Lizards. Sam coughed when he got stuck behind an old gas burner that poured out great gray clouds of stinking exhaust. "Ought to be a law against those miserable things," he complained. Barbara nodded. "They've outlived their usefulness, that's certain." She spoke with the precision of someone who'd done graduate work in English. Yeager minded his P's and Q's more closely than he would have had he not been married to someone like her. At Jose's, the team hashed over the game. Sam was 10 years older than anybody else and the only one who'd ever played pro ball, so his opinions carried weight. His opinion in other areas carried weight, too. Eddie, the pitcher, said, "You deal with the Lizards all the time, Major. What's it going to be like when that big fleet gets here?" "Can't know for sure till it does get here," Yeager answered. "If you want to know what I think it'll be the biggest day since the Conquest fleet came down. We're all doing our best to make sure it isn't the bloodiest day since the Conquest fleet came down, too." Eddie nodded, accepting that. Barbara raised an eyebrow, just a little, so only Sam noticed. She saw the logical flaw the young pitcher missed. If all of mankind wanted the colonization fleet to land peacefully, that would happen. but no one on this side of the Atlantic could guess what Molotov or Himmler might do till he did it, if he did it. And the Nazis and the Reds and the Lizards would be worrying about President Warren, too. After Sam finished his glass of Burgermeister, Barbara said, "I don't want to rush you too much, but we did tell Jonathan we'd be home when he got back." "Okay." Jaeger got up, set a couple of bucks on the table to cover food and drink, and said his goodbyes. Everybody, including Jose from behind the counter, waved when he and Barbara took off. They lived over in Gardena, one of the suburbs on the west side of L.A. that had burgeoned since the end of the fighting. When they got out of the car, Barbara remarked, as she often did, "Cooler here." "It's the sea breeze," Sam answered, as he often did. Then he plucked at his flannel uniform top. "It may be cooler, but it's not that cool. I'm going to hop in the shower is what I'm going to do."
"That would be a very good idea, I think," Barbara said.
Jaeger stuck out his tongue at her. They both laughed, comfortable with each other. Why not? Sam thought. They'd been together since late 1942, only a few months after the conquest fleet arrived. Had the Lizards not come, they never would have met. Sam didn't like thinking about that. Barbara was the best thing that had ever happened to him. To keep from dwelling on might-have-beens, he hurried into the house. Photographs in the hallway that led to the bathroom marked the highlights of his career. Him in dress uniform just after being promoted from sergeant to lieutenant. Him weightless, wearing olive drab undershirt and trousers aboard an orbiting Lizard spaceship, overheated by human standards, as he helped dicker a truce after a flare-up. Him in a spacesuit on the pitted surface of the moon. Him in captain's uniform, standing between Robert Heinlein and Theodore Sturgeon. He grinned at that last one, which he sometimes had to explain to guests. If he hadn't been reading the science fiction pulps, and especially Astounding, he never would have become a specialist in lizard-human relations. Having been overrun by fact, science fiction wasn't what it had been before the Lizards came, but it still had some readers and some writers, and he'd never been a man to renounce his roots. He showered quickly, shaved even more quickly, and put on a pair of chinos and a yellow cotton short-sleeved sport shirt. When he got a beer from the refrigerator, Barbara gave him a piteous look, so he handed it to her and grabbed another one for himself. He'd just taken his first sip when the door opened. "I'm home," Jonathan called. "We're in the kitchen," Jaeger said. Jonathan hurried in. At 18, he hurried everywhere. "I'm hungry," he said, and added an emphatic cough.
"Make yourself a sandwich," Barbara said crisply. "I'm your mother, not your waitress, even if you do have trouble remembering it."
"Take your tongue out of the ginger jar, Mom, I will," Jonathan said, a piece of slang that wouldn't have meant a thing before the Lizards came. He wore only shorts that closely matched his suntanned hide. Across that hide were the bright stripes and patterns of lizard-style body paint. "You've promoted yourself," Sam remarked. "Last week you were a land cruiser driver, but now you're an infantry small unit group leader, a lieutenant more or less." Jonathan paused with his salami sandwich half-built. "The old pattern was getting worn," he answered with a shrug. "The paints you can buy aren't nearly as good as the ones the Lizards..."
"Nearly so good," his mother broke in, precise as usual.
"Nearly so good, then," Jonathan said and shrugged again. "They aren't, and so I washed them off and put on this new set. I like it better, I think. Brighter." "Okay." Sam shrugged, too. People his son's age took the Lizards for granted in a way he never could. The youngsters didn't know what the world had been like before the conquest fleet came. They didn't care, either, and laughed at their elders for waxing nostalgic about it. Recalling his own youth, Sam did his best to be patient. It wasn't always easy. Before he could stop himself, he asked, "Did you really have to shave your head?" That flicked a nerve, where talk about body paint hadn't. Jonathan turned, sliding a hand over the smooth and shining dome of his skull.
"Why shouldn't I?"
he asked, the beginning of an angry rumble in his voice.
"It's the hot thing to do these days."
Along with the body paint, it made people look as much like lizards as they could. Hot was a term of approval because the lizards liked heat. The lizards liked ginger, too, but that was a different story. Sam ran a hand through his own thinning hair. "I'm going bald whether I want to or not, and I don't. I guess I have trouble understanding why anybody who's got hair would want to cut it all off."
"It's hot," Jonathan repeated, as if that explained everything. To him, no doubt it did.
His voice lost some of that belligerent edge as he realized his father wasn't insisting that he let his hair grow, only talking about it. When he didn't feel challenged, he could be rational enough. He took an enormous bite from his sandwich. He was 3 or 4 inches taller than Sam, over 6 feet instead of under, and broader through the shoulders. By the way he ate, he should have been 11 feet tall and 7 feet wide. His second bite was even bigger than the first. He was still chewing when the telephone rang.
"That's got to be Karen,"
he said with his mouth full, and dashed away. Barbara and Sam shared looks of mingled amusement and alarm.
"In my day, girls didn't call boys like that," Barbara said. "In my day, girls didn't shave their heads either. Go on, call me a fuddy-duddy."
"You're my fuddy-duddy," Sam said fondly. He slipped an arm around her waist and gave her a quick kiss.
"I'd better be," Barbara said. "I'm glad I am, too, because there are so many more distractions now. In my day, even if there had been body paint, girls wouldn't have been so thorough about wearing it as boys are. And if they had been, they'd have been arrested for indecent exposure."
"Things aren't the same as they used to be," Sam allowed. His eyes twinkled. "I might call that a change for the better, though." Barbara elbowed him in the ribs.
"Of course you might. That doesn't mean I have to agree with you, though.
And," she lowered her voice so Jonathan wouldn't hear,
"I'm glad Karen isn't one of the ones who do."
"Well, so am I," Sam said, although with a sigh that earned him another pointed elbow. "Jonathan and his pals are a lot more used to skin than I am. I'd stare like a fool if she came over dressed, or not dressed, that way."
"And then you'd tell me you were just reading what her rank was," Barbara said. "You'd think I love you enough to believe a whopper like that. And you know what?"
She poked him again.
"You might even be right."
Fellless had not expected to wake in weightlessness. For a moment, staring up at the fluorescent lights overhead, she wondered if something had gone wrong with the ship. Then, thinking more slowly than she should have because of the lingering effects of cold sleep, she realized how foolish that was. Had something gone wrong with the ship, she would never have awakened at all. Two people floated into view. One, by her body paint, was a physician. The other, weak and scatterbrained as Fellless was, she gave a startled hiss.
"Exalted Fleet Lord," she exclaimed.
She heard her own voice as if from far away. Fleet Lord Refet spoke not to her, but to the physician.
"She recognizes me, I see. Is she capable of real work?"
"We would not have summoned you here, Exalted Fleet Lord, were she incapable," the physician replied. "We understand the value of your time."
"Good," Refet said. "That is a concept the males down on the surface of Tosev III seem to have a great deal of trouble grasping."
He swung one of his eye turrets to bear on Fellless.
"Senior researcher, are you prepared to begin your duties at once?"
"Exalted Fleet Lord, I am," Fellless replied.
Now the voice her hearing diaphragms caught seemed more like her own. Antidotes and restoratives were routing the drugs that had kept her just this side of death on the journey from home to Tosev 3. Curiosity grew along with bodily well-being.
May I ask why I have been awakened prematurely?
You may, Refet said, and then, in an aside to the physician, you were right. Her wits are clear.
He gave his attention back to Fellas.
You have been awakened because conditions on Tosev 3 are not as we anticipated they would be when we set out from home.
That was almost as great a surprise as waking prematurely.
In what way, exalted Fleet Lord?
Fellas tried to make her wits work harder.
Does this planet harbor some bacterium or virus for which we have had difficulty in finding a cure?
Such a thing hadn't happened on either Rabotev 2 or Hallas 1, but remained a theoretical possibility.
No, Refet replied. The difficulty lies in the natives themselves. They are more technically advanced than our probe indicated. You, being the colonization fleet's leading expert on relations between the race and other species, I judged it expedient to rouse you and put you to work before we make planetfall. If you need assistance, give us names, and we shall also wake as many of your subordinates and colleagues as you may require.
Fellas tried to lever herself off the table on which she lay. Straps restrained her, a sensible precaution on the physician's part. As she fumbled with the catches, she asked,
How much more advanced were they than we expected? Enough to make the conquest significantly harder, I gather.
Indeed. Refet added an emphatic cough. When the conquest fleet arrived, they were engaged in active research on jet aircraft, on guided missiles, and on nuclear fission.
That is impossible, Fellas blurted out.
Then, realizing what she'd said, she added,
I beg the exalted Fleet Lord's pardon.
Senior researcher, I freely give it to you,
Refet replied.
When the colonization fleet began receiving data from Tosev 3, my first belief was that Atvar, the fleet lord on the conquest fleet, was playing an elaborate joke on us, jerking our tail stumps, as the saying has it. I have since been disabused of this belief. I wish I had not been, for it strikes me as far more palatable than the truth.
But...
Fellas knew she was stuttering and made herself pause to gather her thoughts.
If that is true, exalted Fleet Lord, I count it something of a marvel that the conquest did not fail.
Such a thought would have been unimaginable back on home. It should have been unimaginable here, too. That she'd imagined it proved it wasn't.
Refet said, In part, senior researcher, the conquest did fail. There are still unsubdued Tosevite empires. Actually, the term the conquest fleet consistently uses is not empires, which I do not altogether understand, on the surface of Tosev 3, along with areas the race has in fact conquered. Nor have the Tosevites ceased their technical progress in the eye blink of time since the conquest fleet arrived. I am warned that only a threat of retaliatory violence from the conquest fleet has kept them from mounting attacks on this colonization fleet.
Fellas felt far dizzier than she would have from weightlessness and sudden revival from cold sleep alone. She finally managed to free herself from the restraining straps and gently push off from the table.
Take me to a terminal at once, if you would be so kind. Have you an edited summary of the data thus far transmitted from the Conquest fleet?
We have, Refet said. I hope you will find it adequate, senior researcher. It was prepared by fleet officers who are not specialists in your area of expertise. We have, of course, provided links to the fuller documentation sent up from Tosev 3.
If you will come with me, superior female, the physician said. She swung rapidly from one handhold to another. Felless followed. She had to strap herself into the chair in front of the terminal to keep the ventilating current from blowing her off it. Getting back to work felt good. She wished she could have waited till reaching the surface of Tosev 3 for reawakening. That would have been as planned back on home, and plans were made to be followed. But she would do the best she could here. And as she called up the summary, a curious blend of anticipation and dread coursed through her. Wild Tosevites. What would dealing with wild Tosevites be like? She'd expected the locals to be well on their way toward assimilation into the Empire by now. Even then, they would have been different from the Halesi and the Rabatevs, who, but for their looks, were as much subjects of the Emperor. Even thinking of her sovereign made Fellis cast down her eyes, as were the males and females of the race. A male in body paint like Refet's appeared on the screen in front of her.
Welcome to Tosev 3, he said in tones anything but welcoming. This is a world of paradox. If you were expecting anything here to be as it was back on home, you will be disappointed. You may very well be dead. The only thing you may safely expect on Tosev 3 is the unexpected. I dare say you who listen to this will not believe me. Were I new come from home, I would not believe such words either. Before rejecting them out of claw, examine the evidence.
A slowly spinning globe of Tosev 3 appeared on the screen. Something over half the land area was red, the rest a variety of other colors. The red, the legend by the globe explained, showed that area of the planet the race controlled. The other colors, which dominated the northern hemisphere, showed areas where the natives still ruled themselves. After Fellis had just long enough to soak in the significance of that, the colors faded, leaving the land areas in more or less their natural colors. Glowing dots, some red, some blue, appeared here and there.
Red dots show explosive metal weapons detonated by the race. Blue dots, those detonated by the Tosevites, a voice said.
Fellis let out a slow, horrified hiss. About as many dots glowed blue as red. Atvar's head and torso reappeared on the screen.
Judging that continuing the war for total conquest might well render this planet useless to the colonization fleet, we entered into negotiations with the Tosevite not empires possessing explosive metal weapons, conceding their independence in exchange for a cessation of hostilities, the leader of the conquest fleet said. On the whole, there have been certain unpleasant exceptions. Peace between the race and the Tosevites, and among the Tosevite factions, has prevailed for the past 34 years. 17 of this planet's revolutions, which are just over twice as long as ours. I freely admit it is not the sort of peace I would have desired. There were, however, many times when I thought it was more than I would ever get. See for yourself what we faced, even at the beginning of our struggle against the Tosavites.
His image faded to be replaced by those of land cruisers of obviously alien manufacture. The tracked and armored fortresses were not a match for those of the race, but the barbarous inhabitants of Tosev III, by everything Fellless knew, should not have been able to build land cruisers at all.
3 years later, we were facing these, Atvar said.
New land cruisers replaced those formerly on the screen. They looked more formidable. Their specifications said they were more formidable. They carried more armor and bigger guns and had more powerful engines. They still didn't match the machines the race used, but they were getting closer.
3 years, Fellis said in almost disbelieving wonder. 1.5 of Tosev III's years.
The later model land cruisers looked to be separated from the earlier ones by a couple of hundred years of slow development. On home, they would have been. Tosavite aircraft showed the same astonishing leap in technical prowess. The natives had gone from machines propelled by rotating airfoils to jets and rocket-powered killer craft in what amounted to the flick of a nictitating membrane across an eye.
How? Fellis murmured. How could they have done such a thing?
As if answering her, Atvar said,
Explanations for the Tosavites' extraordinary proficiency fall into two main areas, which may or may not be mutually exclusive, the geographical and the biological. Oceans and mountains break up Tosavite landmasses in ways unknown on other worlds of the Empire, fostering the formation of small, competitive groups.
The globe reappeared, this time splotched in ways that struck Fellis as absurdly complex.
These were the political divisions on Tosev III at the time the conquest fleet arrived.
Atvar continued,
Reproductive biology among the Tosavites is unlike that of any other intelligent race we know, and has profound effects on their society. Females are or can be continually receptive. Males are or can be continually active. This leads to pair bondings and...
He went on for some time. Long before he'd finished, Fellis hissed out a single word,
Disgusting!
She wondered how so aberrant a species had ever developed intelligence, let alone a technology that let it challenge the race. At last, and very much to her relief, the fleet lord of the conquest fleet chose another topic. She listened until Atvar finished.
This conquest, if it is to be accomplished, will be a matter for generations, not days as was anticipated when we left home. The landing of the colonization fleet and settlement of the colonists will greatly aid in integrating the independent not empires into the larger structure of the empire. Exposure to proper examples cannot help but lead the big uglies.
By then, Fellis had gathered that was the conquest fleet's nickname for the Tosavites,
to emulate the high example that will be placed before them.
His image vanished from the screen. Fellis turned to Refet.
You were right to rouse me, exalted Fleet Lord. This will be a more challenging problem than anyone could have anticipated, and no doubt the Conquest Fleet has made its share of mistakes in dealing with these bizarre Tosavites.
She let out a hissing sigh.
I can see I shall have my work cut out for me.
Without false modesty, Vyacheslav Molotov knew himself to be one of the three most powerful men on the face of the earth. Without false self-aggrandizement, he knew Atvar, the lizard's fleet lord, was more powerful than he, or Heinrich Himmler, or Earl Warren. What had not been obvious over the past two crowded decades was whether Atvar was more powerful than the leaders of the USSR, the Greater German Reich, and the USA put together. But soon, very soon, the lizard's colonization fleet would bring millions more of their kind, males and females both, to Earth. Even though the fleet was entirely civilian, the lizards had not anticipated needing more military help when it left their homeworld, it would tilt the scales in their direction. It could hardly do anything else. As he sat in his Kremlin office, Molotov did not show what he was thinking. He had reached the top of the Soviet hierarchy, succeeding Joseph Stalin as General Secretary of the Communist Party, not least by never showing what he was thinking. His stone face, poker face was the American idiom which he rather liked, had also served him well in dealing with foreigners and with the lizards. His own secretary stuck his head into the office.
"Comrade General Secretary, the Foreign Commissar has arrived."
"Very well, Pyotr Maximovich. Send him in," Molotov answered. He glanced at his wristwatch as the secretary disappeared. 10 o'clock on the dot. Since no one could see him do it, Molotov nodded approval. Some people understood the virtue of punctuality, however un-Russian it was. In strode Andrei Gromyko.
"Good day, Vyacheslav Mikhailovich," he said, extending his hand.
Molotov shook it.
"And to you, Andrei Andreevich," he said, and gestured to the chair across the desk from his own. "Sit down."
Without any further small talk, Gromyko did. Molotov thought well of the foreign commissar, not least because his craggy countenance revealed almost as little as Molotov's own. Gromyko went straight to business, another trait of which Molotov approved.
"Is there any change in our position of which I should be aware before we meet with the lizard's ambassador to the Soviet Union?"
"I do not believe so, no," Molotov replied. "We remain strongly opposed to their settling colonists in Persia or Afghanistan or Kashmir or any other land near our borders."
One of Gromyko's shaggy eyebrows twitched.
"Any other Vyacheslav Mikhailovich?" he asked.
Molotov grunted. Gromyko had caught him fair and square.
"You are correct, of course. We have no objection whatever to their colonization of Poland, however extensive that may prove."
While withdrawing from most of their European conquests, the lizards had stayed in Poland. Neither Germany nor the USSR was willing to see it in the other's hands, and neither was willing to see a Polish state revive. With the lizards administering the area, it made a splendid buffer zone between the Soviet Union and Nazi-dominated Western Europe. Molotov was delighted to have the lizards there. He feared the Greater German Reich, and hoped with all his heart that Himmler likewise feared the USSR.
Gromyko said, "I remind you, Comrade General Secretary, that the lizards have consistently maintained we have no right to dictate to them where they may settle on territory they rule."
"We are not dictating. We are not in a position to dictate, however unfortunate that may be," Molotov said. "We are making our views known to them. We are in a position to do that. If they choose to ignore us, they show themselves to be uncultured and give us grounds for ignoring them in appropriate circumstances. They are of the opinion, the strong opinion, that we ignore their views by continuing to supply weapons to progressive forces in China and Afghanistan," Gromyko said.
"I cannot imagine why they continue to hold such an opinion," Molotov said. "We have repeatedly denied any such involvement."
Gromyko did own an impressive stone face, for he failed to crack a smile at that. So did Molotov. Here, as so often, denials and truth bore little relation to each other. But the lizards had never quite been able to prove Soviet denials were false, and so the denials continued.
"A thought," Gromyko said, raising a forefinger.
"Go on,"
Molotov nodded. His neck creaked a little as he did so. He was up past 70, his face more wrinkled than it had been when the lizards first came to Earth, his hair thinner and almost entirely gray. Aging mattered relatively little to him. He had never been a man who relied on creating an overwhelming physical impression.
Gromyko said, "Should the Yashcheretsi offer not to settle heavily along our southern border, if we truly do stop arms shipments that annoy them, how ought we to respond?"
"Ah, that is interesting, Andrei Andreevich," Molotov said. "Do you think they would have the imagination to propose such a bargain?"
Before Gromyko could answer, Molotov went on.
"If they do not, should we propose it to them?"
Now he did smile, unpleasantly.
"How Mao would howl."
"So he would. Seldom have I met a man who had so much arrogance," Gromyko said. "Hitler came close, but Hitler actually led a state where Mao has spent the last 30 years wishing he could."
"Even so," Molotov agreed.
He pondered. Would he sell his Chinese ideological brethren down the river to gain advantage for the Soviet Union? He did not need to ponder long.
"I hope Queek does propose it. If we do so, it may suggest weakness to the lizards. But we can raise the issue if we must. Keeping the lizards well away from us counts for more than keeping Mao happy."
"I agree, Comrade General Secretary," Gromyko said. "The lizards will not settle China in any great numbers. It already has too many people. Mao's chief value to us is keeping the countryside unsettled, and he will do that with or without our arms."
"A very pretty solution indeed,"
Molotov said, warming up all the way to tepid.
"One way or another, we shall use it."
Molotov's secretary came in and announced,
"The ambassador from the race and his interpreter are here."
He did not call the lizard a lizard, not where the said lizard or the interpreter could hear him. Queek skittered into Molotov's office. He was about the size of a 10-year-old, though he seemed smaller because of his forward-slung posture. One of his eye turrets, weirdly like a chameleon's, swiveled toward Molotov, the other toward Gromyko. Molotov could not read his body paint, but its ornateness declared his high rank. He addressed Molotov and Gromyko in his own hissing language. The interpreter, a tall, stolid, middle-aged human, spoke good Russian with a Polish accent.
"The ambassador greets you in the name of the emperor."
"Tell him that we greet him in return in the name of the workers and peasants of the Soviet Union,"
Molotov answered. He smiled again, down where it did not show. At his very first meeting with the lizards, not long after their invasion, he'd had the pleasure of letting them know that the Soviets had liquidated the Tsar and his family. Their own emperors had ruled them for 50,000 years. The news taught them, better than anything else could have done, that they were not dealing with creatures of a familiar sort. The interpreter hissed and squeaked and popped and coughed. Queek made similar appalling noises. Again, the interpreter translated.
"The ambassador says he is not certain this meeting has any point, as he has already made it clear to the foreign commissar that your views on the settlement of the race are unacceptable."
Even more than the Nazis, the lizards were convinced they were the lords of creation and everyone else their natural subjects. As he had almost 20 years before, Molotov took pleasure in reminding them they might be wrong.
"If we are sufficiently provoked, we will attack the colonization fleet in space."
If we are sufficiently provoked, we will serve the present rulers of the Soviet Union as you butchers served your emperor,
Queek retorted. The interpreter looked as if he enjoyed translating the lizard's reply. Molotov wondered what grievance he held against the Soviet Union. No time to worry about that now, Molotov said.
Whatever sacrifices are required of us, we shall make them.
He wondered how true that was. It had certainly been true a generation before, with the Soviet people mobilized to battle first the Nazis and then the lizards. Now, after a time of comfort, who could be sure if it still was? But the lizards might not, he hoped they did not, know that.
Queek said, Even after so long, I cannot understand how you Tosevites can be such madmen. You are willing to destroy yourselves so long as you can also harm your foes.
This often makes our foes less eager to attack us, Andrei Gromyko pointed out. Sometimes we must convince people we mean what we say. Your taste for aggression, for instance, is less than it was before you encountered the determination of the Soviet people.
By studying motion pictures of prisoners, Molotov had gained a good working knowledge of what lizards' gestures and motions meant. Gromyko had succeeded in alarming Queek. Molotov added,
If you expect to get good treatment from us, you must show us good treatment in return.
That was a lesson the lizards had had a hard time learning. It was also an invitation to dicker. Would Queek see as much? Molotov wasn't sure. The lizards were better diplomats now than they had been when they first came. They had more practice at the art, too. They weren't stupid. Anyone who thought otherwise quickly paid the price. But they were naive, even more naive than Americans.
The converse should also apply, Queek said. Why should we even deal with you when you keep sending weapons to those who would overthrow our rule?
We deny this, Molotov said automatically.
But did Queek offer an opening? Molotov was willing to trade hint for hint.
Why should we trust you when you plainly plan on packing the borders with your kind?
Queek paused before replying. Was he also trying to decide whether he heard the beginnings of a deal? At last he said,
We should have less need to rely on the race's military might if you did not keep provoking your surrogates against us with hopes of a triumph surely impossible.
Have you not seen, Ambassador, how little is impossible on this world? Molotov said.
We have seen this, yes, seen it to our sorrow, Queek replied. Were it not so, I would not be here negotiating with you. But since I am, perhaps we can discuss this matter further.
Perhaps we can, Molotov said. I have doubts as to whether it will come to anything, but perhaps we can.
He watched Queek lean forward slightly.
Yes, the lizard was serious.
Molotov did not smile. Getting down to business was a capitalist phrase, but in the privacy of his own mind, he used it anyway.
Totomels politely inclined his head. It is a pleasure to see a new face from home, superior female, he said to the researcher from the colonization fleet who had come to consult with him. On the whole, he was telling the truth. He had not always got on well with the colleagues who had accompanied him in the colonization fleet, or with the big uglies he studied.
In this matter, I should call you superior, sir, the newcomer, her name was Fellless, replied. You have the expertise. You have the experience with these Tosevites.
More than I ever wanted, Tetomels thought, remembering captivity in China he'd expected to lead to his death. Aloud, he said, You are gracious. Which was also true, for Fellis' body paint showed that she outranked him. You have had all the time since the arrival of the conquest fleet to assimilate the implausible nature of the natives of Tosif III, Fellas said. To me, having to try to understand it in a matter of days, a most hasty and inefficient procedure, it seems not merely implausible, but impossible. This was our reaction on reaching this world, too, Tetomel said. We have since had to adapt to changing conditions. He let his mouth fall open. Anyone on Tosev III who fails to adapt is ruined. We have seen that demonstrated, and most often painfully demonstrated, time and again. So I gather, Fellas said, it must have been very difficult for you. Change, after all, is an unnatural condition. So I thought before leaving home, Tetomels replied. So I still think at times, for so I was trained to think all my life. But had we not changed, the best we could have done would have been to destroy this planet. And where would that have left you and the colonization fleet, superior female? Fellas did not take him seriously. He could tell at a glance. He barely needed one eye turret to see it, let alone two. That saddened him, but hardly surprised him. She had the beginnings of an intellectual understanding of what the race had been through on Tosif III. Tetomels had been through every bit of it. The scars still marked his spirit. It would never be free of them till it met the spirits of emperors past face to face. You are to be commended for your diligent efforts to gain understanding of the roots of Tosavite behavior, Fellas said. Nice to know someone thinks so, Tetomel said, remembering quarrels down through the years. Some males, I think, would sooner stay ignorant, and some would sooner put their tongues in a ginger jar and forget their research and everything else. He waited. Sure enough, Fellas asked a hesitant question. Ginger? I have seen the name in the reports. It must refer to a drug native to Tosev III, for it is certainly unknown back on home. Yes, it's an herb that grows here, Tetomels said. For the natives, it is just a spice, the way balj is back on home. It is a drug for us, though, and a nasty one. It makes a male feel smart and bold and strong. And when it wears off, it makes him feel like having some more. Once it gets its claws in you, you will do almost anything for another taste. With more enforcement personnel here now, we should be able to root it out without much trouble, Fellas said. Tetomels remembered that pristine confidence, that sense that things would keep going smoothly because they always had. He'd known it himself. Then he'd started dealing with the big uglies. Like so many males on Tosev III, he'd lost it and never got it back. He didn't try to explain that to Fellas. The female would find out for herself. Why would anyone want a drug in the first place, especially an alien drug? Fellas asked him. At first, because you are bored, or else because you see someone else having a good time and you want one too, he answered. We shall have trouble with ginger when the colonists land. Mark my words. I shall record your prediction, Fellas said. I tend to doubt its accuracy, but, as I said, you are the one with experience on Tosev III, so perhaps you will prove correct in the end. Was she so serious all the time? A lot of people back on home were. Tetomels remembered as much. Contact with the big uglies, even contact with males who had contact with the big uglies, had a way of abrading such seriousness.
And now 100 million colonists, once revived, would look on the relative handful of males from the colonization fleet as slightly addled eggs. Tetomels didn't see what anyone could do about that, either. Deep inside, he laughed to himself. Eventually, the colonists would have to start dealing with the Tosavites. Then they'd get addled, too. In spite of his best efforts to believe otherwise, Tetomels could reach no other conclusion. Even if Tosev III at last came completely under the Emperor's rule, it would be the odd world out in more ways than one for years, centuries, millennia to come. Because he'd been mentally picking parasites out from under his scales, he missed a comment from Fellless.
"I am sorry, Superior Female," he said, embarrassed. "I said that of all the researchers with the Conquest Fleet, you seem to have gone furthest in your efforts to examine the integration of Tosavites and the race."
Fellless repeated the compliment with no sign of exasperation. She continued,
"Some of your activities strike me as going above and beyond the call of duty."
"You are generous, Superior Female," Tetomels said. "My view has always been that if this world is to be successfully colonized, effecting such integration will be mandatory."
"You doubt the possibility of successful colonization?"
Now Fellless sounded reproving, not complimentary.
"I doubt the certainty of successful colonization," Tetomels replied. "Anyone with experience of Tosev III doubts the certainty of anything pertaining to it." "And yet you have persisted," Fellless said. "In your reports, you indicate that your first experimental specimen was forcibly taken away from you, and that you yourself were kidnapped by Tosevite bandits while seeking to obtain a replacement for it."
"Truth," Tetomels said. "We badly underestimated the importance of family bonds on Tosev III, due not only to long-term sexual pairings, but also to the absurdly helpless nature of Tosevite hatchlings, which need constant care if they are to survive. Because of these factors, my experiments have met with far more opposition from the Big Uglies than they would have from any other intelligent race with which we are familiar. And yet, in the end, your work seems to have met with success," Fellless said. "I wonder if you would be so kind as to allow me to make the acquaintance of the specimen you finally succeeded in obtaining and rearing."
"I thought you might ask that."
Tetomels rose.
"Casquit is waiting in the next chamber. I shall return in a moment. My first Tosavite, even if not quite a wild specimen," Fellless said in musing tones. "How interesting this will be. Please do your best to treat the Big Ugly as you would a member of the race," Tetomels warned. "Since the Tosavite gained speech, which Big Uglies do more quickly than our own hatchlings, all males have followed this course, which appears to have worked well." "It shall be done," Fellless promised.
Tetomels went into the adjacent chamber where Casquit sat in front of a screen, engrossed in a game.
"The researcher from home wishes to speak with you," Tetomels said. "It shall be done, Superior Sir," Casquit said obediently, and got up.
The Big Ugly, though not large for a Tosavite, stood head and neck above Tetomels. Casquit followed him back to the chamber where Fellless waited. Bending into the posture of respect, the Tosavite said to her,
"I greet you, Superior Sir." "Superior Female," Tetomels corrected. He turned to Fellless. "You are the first female Casquit has met." "I am very pleased to make your acquaintance, Casquit," Fellless said.
I thank you, superior female.
Casquet used the correct title this time. The Big Ugly's voice was slightly mushy. Tosavite mouth parts could not quite handle all the sounds of the language of the race.
You are truly from home?
I am, Fellless said.
I would like to visit home, Casquet said wistfully, but cold sleep has not yet been adapted to my biochemistry.
Perhaps it will one day, Fellless said.
Tatomals watched her try to hide surprise. Casquet was young, but far from stupid. Fellless went on.
Rabatevs and Halesi travel between the stars. No reason Tosavites should not as well.
I hope you are right, superior female.
Casquet turned small, immobile eyes toward Tatomals.
May I be excused, superior sir?
Was that shyness or a desire to return to the game? Whatever it was, Tatomals yielded to it. You may.
I thank you, superior sir. I am glad to have met you, superior female.
After another respectful bend, Casquet left, tall and ridiculously erect.
Brighter than I expected, Fellless remarked once the Big Ugly was gone. Less alien-seeming, too. Far less so than the Tosavites in the images I have seen.
That is by design to aid in integration, Tatomals said. The body paint, of course, designates Casquet as my apprentice. The unsightly hair at the top of the Tosavite's head is frequently clipped to the skin. When Casquet reached sexual maturity, more hair grew at the armpits and around the genital area, though Casquet's race is less hairy than most Tosavites.
What is the function of these hairy patches that emerge at sexual maturity? Fellless asked. I presume they pertain to reproduction in some way.
That is not yet fully understood, Tatomals admitted. They may help spread pheromones from odorous glands in these areas, but Tosavite reproductive behavior is less closely tied to odor cues than our own.
Are these creatures truly accessible to one another at all seasons? Fellless asked.
A wriggle said what she thought of the idea. But Tatomals had to answer.
Truly, and they find our way as strange and repugnant as we find theirs. I confess that, despite my scientific objectivity, I have a great deal of trouble grasping this. Surely our way is far more convenient. You are not in season. My scent receptors know as much. And so you are simply a colleague. No complications involved with mating need arise.
And a good thing, too, Fellless exclaimed.
She and Tatomals both laughed at the absurdities of the Big Uglies.
Home.
Casquet tasted the sound of the word. Home was more real in the Tosavite's mind than Tosev III, around which this ship had orbited longer than Casquet had been alive.
Tosavite, Casquet thought. That is what I call myself, and why not? That is what I am. It didn't seem right. It didn't seem fair.
Without this preposterously large, preposterously ugly body, Casquet knew the nickname the males of the race, and no doubt this new female, too, had for Tosavites. The good brain inside this strangely domed skull might have accomplished something worthwhile. Oh, it still might, but that was far less likely than it would have been otherwise.
If I had been hatched on home, Casquet said,
and how many times had that thought echoed and re-echoed? More than Casquet could count.
Did I ask for this body? Spirits of emperors past, did I?
The eyes that looked down at the metal floor could not slew in turrets.
And is that my fault?
Every step Casquit took was a reminder of alienness. This tosavite body would not bend forward into a proper posture, or what would have been a proper posture for anyone else. And the lack of true claws on Casquit's fingertips was another inconvenience. Tetomels had turned out prosthetics that made operating machinery much easier. A proper member of the race, though, would not have needed prosthetics.
"I am not a proper member of the race. I am a Tosavite, brought up as if I were a proper member of the race, or as close to a proper member of the race as I can be, given my limitations. Oh, how I wish I had no such limitations! I am part person, part experimental animal."
Casquit did not resent that. The race needed experimental animals to learn how to live with and eventually rule the tempestuous Tosavites. Tetomels had said as little about the natives of Tosev III as he could. From the small things he had let fall now and then, Casquit understood what an honor, what a privilege it had been to be selected for this role. Life as a Tosavite peasant? Casquit's mouth dropped open in scornful amusement at the idea. A small sound escaped Casquit's mouth along with the laugh. "I should have better control," Casquit thought. "I usually do have better control, but I am upset." Tetomels had said that Tosavites show amusement with a noise rather than in the race's far more sophisticated, far more elegant fashion.
"I do not want to act like a Tosavite. In no way do I want to act like a Tosavite. I am one, but I wish I were not."
Some things could not be helped. Posture was one. Skin was another. Casquit ran one hand along the other arm.
"I should be a dark greenish-brown like a proper male of the race, or even, I discover, a proper female of the race. Instead, I am a sort of pale yellowish-tan color, a very disagreeable shade for a person to be." "And my skin is smooth," Casquit said with a sad sigh. "It will never be anything but smooth, I fear."
Casquit sighed again.
"When I was coming out of hatchlinghood, how I waited till it would be like the ones everybody else had. I did not really understand then how different I was. The Emperor surely knows I do try to fit in as best I can."
The skin under Casquit's palm was also faintly damp. Tetomels had explained why that was so. Instead of panting to cool the body, Tosavites used the evaporation of metabolic water. Tosev III was a wetter world than home, which let the big uglies expend water so lavishly. Tosev III was also a colder world than home, which meant the ship, whose climate was home-like, seemed warm to Casquit's Tosavite body and prompted the activation of the cooling mechanism. It all made good sense. Tetomels had patiently explained it over and over to Casquit. It was, for Tosavites, thoroughly normal. It was also thoroughly disgusting as far as Casquit was concerned. Other things about the Tosavite body were even more disgusting. The business of passing liquid waste as well as solid, for instance. That had to do with Tosev III's revolting wetness. Again, Tetomels had been patience itself in explaining the reasons behind the differences.
"I don't care about the reasons," Casquit muttered. "I wish there were no differences." "I am usually not like this," Casquit thought. "Usually I can see what makes me more like the race, not what separates me from it. I wish I had not met Fellis. Seeing someone freshly come from home reminds me that I am not, and I cannot be. That hurts. It hurts worse than I expected."
An itch on top of the head made Casquit scratch. Very, very short hair rasped under the not-quite claws at the tips of Casquit's fingers. Hair was another nasty thing about the Tosavite body.
"I wish I did not have any," Casquit thought. "Smooth is bad. Hairy is even worse. Emperor be praised that I do get clipped regularly. I wished I could die when the hair started sprouting here and there on my body. Having to get my head clipped is humiliation enough. Add these other spots, and it is almost too much to bear. Tetomels had been reassuring about that, too. The race's research proved it was normal among Tosavites of about Casquit's age. But it was not normal aboard the ship. It made Casquit even more abnormal here. What would I do without Tetomels? Casquit wondered. The male had been a guide, a teacher, a mentor, a hearing diaphragm to listen for all of Casquit's life. A hearing diaphragm to listen? I will not think about the strange curls of flesh at the sides of my head, nor about the holes inside them with which I hear. I will not think about them. I will not. Trying not to think about something worked as well as that usually did. Casquit touched an ear, then gave it a painful yank. Maybe I should have these clipped. It would not be too hard, and it would make me look a little closer to the way I should. Tetomels had not wanted to put a mirror in Casquit's compartment. His argument had been that looking at such a different face would only lead to discontentment. I will be more discontented if you do not treat me as if I were a part of the race, Casquit remembered saying. If I were a member of the race, I would have one. Tetomels had yielded. It was the first argument Casquit had ever won from him. The technician who had installed the mirror in the compartment had treated Casquit like a member of the race, all right. He had fastened it at a level that would have been perfect for a member of the race. Casquit had to stoop to see anything but the paint marking this unsatisfactory body's unsatisfactory torso. Stooping, Casquit thought, this is how I look. I cannot do anything about it. Small eyes, white with dark center, folds of skin at their inner corners narrowing them further still, without nearly the angle of vision the race enjoyed. Casquit had had strips of hair above them, too. Tosavite signaling organs, Tetomels called them. But those strips got clipped with the rest. A projection below and between the eyes that housed the nostrils. An absurdly small mouth with mobile, soft tissue around it and a wildly variegated set of teeth inside. Out came Casquit's tongue for a critical examination. It needed criticizing, all right, being short and blunt and unforked. Again, and not for the first time, Casquit wondered whether surgery could correct that flaw. What is the use? Casquit said, straightening once more. What is the use of any of it? They can cut this and clip those and maybe do some other things too, but it will not help. Not really. I will still look like this. Maybe Tetomels had been right. Maybe the mirror should have stayed out. In the end, though, how much would it have mattered? I am a Tosavite. I wish I were not, but I am. With or without a mirror, I know it. Casquit went over to the computer terminal, put on false finger claws, and returned to the earlier game. But it didn't engross as it had before going in to see Fellless. Reality has a way of breaking in, Casquit thought. The best thing about the computer is that it does not know, or if it does know, it does not care. It really does not care I am a Tosavite. That is one of the reasons it is so much fun. As far as the computer is concerned, I am as good as anybody else. How can I go on believing that, even imagining that, after meeting a female straight from home? Home, Casquit said again, making the word a drawn-out sigh of longing. I know what to do. If I am presented to the Emperor, I know how to bend. I know all the proper responses. I would make Tetomels proud. Another open-mouthed laugh, this one at least properly silent. As if anyone would present a Tosavite to the Emperor. Casquit paused.
A Tosavite might be presented to the Emperor, but as a curiosity, not as a person who reverenced him as the race and the Helesi and the Rabatevs did. That was not good enough. It made Casquit angry. I deserve to reverence the Emperor like anyone else. Calm yourself, you are growing too excited, Tetomels would have said had he been there and known what was in Casquit's mind. Calm did not come easily. As Tetomels had explained it, the hormones that produced physical maturation in Tosavites were also liable to produce mood swings wilder than any the race experienced outside the brief mating season. Tetomels told the truth there as elsewhere, Casquit thought. All things considered, I would sooner not have gone through maturation. Another reluctant trip to the mirror. This time, Casquit did not stoop, but sighed after looking away at last. Sure enough, the twin bulges of tissue in the upper part of the torso made the lines of her body paint harder to read than they should have been. And that was far from the worst of the changes she had undergone. Growing the new patches of hair had been very bad. And had Tetomels not warned her she would suffer a cyclic flow of blood from her genital opening, she would surely have thought she was ill from some dire disease when it began. The race suffered no such grotesque inconveniences. Tetomels had arranged to bring Tosavite sanitary pads up from the surface of the world below for her. They worked well enough, but that she needed such things galled her. But more upsetting even than that were the feelings coursing through her for which the language of the race seemed to have no names. With them, for once, Tetomels had been little help. Dispassionate remarks about reproductive behavior did nothing to slow the thudding of Casquit's heart, the whistle of the breath through her, the feeling that the compartment was even warmer than normal. She had found something that did. Her hand slid down along her painted belly. Of itself, her stance shifted so her feet were wider apart than usual. She looked up at the ceiling, not really seeing it, not really seeing anything. After a bit, she exhaled very hard and quivered a little. Her fingers were damp. She wiped them on a tissue. She knew she would be easier for a while now. 2. Peking brawled around Luhan. She wore the long, dark blue tunic and trousers and the conical straw hat of a peasant woman. She had no trouble playing the role. She'd lived it till the little scaly devils came down from the sky and turned China, turned the whole world, upside down. Her daughter, Lu Mei, who walked along the hutong, the alleyway, beside her, was proof of that. Turning to Lu Han, she said, "I hope we won't be late." "Don't worry," Lu Han answered. "We've got plenty of time." Lu Mei nodded, her face serious. Her face was almost always serious, even when she laughed. The scaly devils had taken her from Luhan right after she was born and had kept her in one of their airplanes that never landed for her first year of life outside the womb, her second year of age, as the Chinese reckon such things. When a baby, she should have learned to smile by watching people around her. But she'd had only little scaly devils around her, and they never smiled. They could not smile. Lu Mei hadn't learned how. "I should have liquidated that Tetomels when I had the chance," Lu Han said, her hands folding into fists. "Mercy has no place in the struggle against imperialism. I understand that now much better than I did when you were tiny."
"Truly, Mother, too late to fret over it now," Lu Mei replied, seriously.
Lu Han walked on in grim silence. Her daughter was right, but that left her no happier. She and Lu Mei both flattened themselves against the splintery front wall of a shop as a burly, sweating man with a load of bricks on a carrying pole edged past them going the other way. He leered at Lu Mei, showing a couple of broken teeth.
"If you show me your body, I will show you silver," he said.
"No," Lu Mei answered.
Lu Han did not think that was rejection enough, or anywhere close to it.
"Go on, get out of here, you stinking turtle!" she screeched at the laborer. "Just because your mother was a whore, you think all women are whores."
"You would starve as a whore,"
the man snarled, but he walked on. The Hutong opened out onto Pingtse Mentache, the main street leading east into Peking from the Pingtse Gate.
"Be careful," Lu Han murmured to Lu Mei. "Scaly devils seldom come into Hutongs, and they are often sorry when they do. But they do patrol the main streets."
Sure enough, here came a squad of them, swaggering down the middle of the broad street and expecting everyone to get out of their way. When people didn't move fast enough to suit them, they shouted either in their own language, which they expected humans to understand, or in bad Chinese. Lu Han kept walking. Even after 20 years of practice, the scaly devils had trouble telling one person from another. Lu Mei bent her head so the brim of her hat helped hide her features. She did not look quite like a typical Chinese, and a bright little devil might notice as much.
"They are past us," Lu Han said quietly, and her daughter straightened up once more.
Lu Mei's eyes were of the proper almond shape. Her nose, though, was almost as prominent as a foreign devil's, and her face was narrower and more forward-thrusting than Lu Han's. The black hair the hat concealed refused to lie straight, but had a springy wave to it. She was a pretty girl, prettier than I was at that age, Lu Han thought, which worried her mother as much as or more than it pleased her. Lu Mei's father, an American named Bobby Fiore, was dead. The scaly devils had shot him before she was born. Before that, he, like Lu Han, had been a captive on one of those airplanes that never landed. They'd been forced to couple. The little scaly devils had enormous trouble understanding matters of the pillow, hardly surprising when they came into heat like barnyard animals, and he'd got her with child. Off to the east, toward or maybe past the Forbidden City, gunfire crackled. The sound was absurdly cheerful, like the fireworks used to celebrate the new year. Lu Mei said,
"I didn't know we were doing anything today."
"We're not," Lu Han said shortly. The communists were not the only ones carrying on a long guerrilla campaign against the scaly devils. The reactionaries of the Kuomintang had not abandoned the field. They and Mao's followers fought each other as well as the little devils. And the eastern dwarfs kept sending men across the Sea of Japan to raise trouble for the little scaly devils and the Chinese alike. Japan had had imperialist pretensions in China years before the little devils arrived, and resented being excluded from what had been her bowl of rice. More scaly devils whizzed past, these in a vehicle mounting a machine gun. They headed in the direction of the firing. None of them turned so much as an eye turret in Lu Han's direction. Lu Han decided to make a lesson of it.
"This is why we are strong in the cities," she said to Lu Mei. "In the cities, we swim unnoticed. In the countryside, where every family has known its neighbors forever and a day, staying hidden is harder."
"I understand, Mother," Lu Mei said, "but this also works for the Kuomintang, doesn't it?"
"Oh, yes," Lu Han agreed. "A knife will cut for whoever takes it in hand."
She nodded to her daughter.
"You are quick. You need to be quick the way the world is today."
When she was Lu Mei's age, and even older, all she'd wanted to do was go on living as she and her ancestors always had. But the Japanese had come to her village, killing her husband and her little son. And then the little scaly devils had come, driving out the eastern dwarfs and capturing her. She, who had not even thought of going to the city, was uprooted from everything she'd ever known. And she'd thrived. Oh, it hadn't been easy, but she'd done it. She had abilities she hadn't even suspected.
Once in a while, when she was in an uncommonly kindly mood, she thought she owed the little scaly devils some gratitude for liberating her from her former, ever-so-limited life. She glanced over to Lu Mei. She owed the scaly devils something else for what they'd done to her daughter. And she'd been giving them what she owed them ever since. That debt might never be paid in full, but she intended to keep on trying. Lu Mei's face did not change much, even when she laughed. She laughed now, laughed and pointed. "Look, Mother, more devil boys." "I see them," Lu Han said grimly. She did not find the young people, boys and shameless girls too, in any way amusing. When foreign devils from Europe spread their imperialistic web through China, some Chinese had imitated them in dress and food and way of life because they were powerful. The same thing was happening now with respect to the scaly devils. This particular pack of devil boys took things further than most. Like most such bands, they wore tight shirts and trousers printed in patterns that mimicked body paint. But several had shaved not only their heads, but also their eyebrows in an effort to make themselves look as much like scaly devils as they could. They larded their speech with affirmative and interrogative coughs and words from the little scaly devil's language. Many older people gave way before them, almost as they might have for real scaly devils. Lu Han did not. Stolid as if she were alone on the sidewalk, she strode straight through them, Lu Mei beside her.
"Be careful, foolish female," one of the devil boys hissed in the scaly devil's tongue.
His friends giggled to hear him insult someone who would not understand. But Lu Han did understand. That she was part of the revolutionary struggle against the little scaly devils did not mean she had not studied them, just the opposite, in fact. She whirled and hissed back, "Be silent, hatchling from an addled egg!" How the devil boys stared. Not all of them understood what she'd said, but they could hardly fail to understand that a plain, middle-aged woman spoke the little devil's language at least as well as they did, and that she was not afraid of them. The ones who did understand giggled again, this time at their friend's discomfiture. The boy who had first mocked Lu Han spoke in Chinese now.
"How did you learn that language?"
He did not even add an interrogative cough.
"None of your business," Lu Han snapped.
She was already regretting her sharp answer. She and Lu Mei were not perfectly safe in Peking. Sometimes the little devils treated Chinese Communist Party officials like officials from the foreign devils' governments they recognized. Sometimes they treated them like bandits, even if the Communists made them sorry when they did.
"What about you, good-looking one?"
The devil boy shifted back to the scaly devil's speech to aim a question at Lu Mei. He showed ingenuity as well as brashness, for the little devil's language was short on endearments. They did not need them among themselves, not when they had a mating season and no females to put them into it.
"I am none of your business either,"
Lu Mei answered in the little devil's tongue. She'd begun to pick it up as her birth speech before Tatamults had returned her to Lu Han. Maybe that had helped her reacquire it later after she'd become fluent in Chinese. She threw in an emphatic cough to show how much she wasn't the devil boy's business. Instead of deflating, he laughed and folded himself into the scaly devil's posture of respect.
"It shall not be done, superior female,"
he said with an emphatic cough of his own. That was when he began to interest Lu Han.
"You speak the little scaly devil's language well," she said in Chinese. "What is your name?"
"I ought to say none of your business," the devil boy replied. That was apt to be true in more ways than one. People who asked such questions could put those who answered them in danger. But the devil boy went on,
"It does not much matter, though, for everyone knows I am Dao Sheng Ming."
He returned to the scaly devil's tongue.
"Is that not a foolish name for a male of the race?"
Those of his friends who understood whooped with glee and slapped their thighs with the palms of their hands. In spite of herself,
Lu Han smiled. Dao Sheng Ming seemed to take nothing seriously, not his own Chinese blood, and not the little devils he aped either. But he was plainly bright. If he discovered the proper ideology, he might become very valuable. Thoughtfully, Lu Han said,
"Well, Dao Sheng Ming, if you are ever on Nanyang Shikuo, South Sheep Market Mouth, in the eastern part of the city, you might look for Ma's brocade shop there."
"And what would I find in it?" Dao asked.
"Why, brocade, of course," Lu Han answered innocently. "Ask for old Lin. He will show you everything you need."
If Dao Sheng Ming did ask for old Lin, he would be recruited. Maybe he would pay attention. Maybe, being a devil boy with an itch for trouble, he wouldn't. Still, Lu Han judged the effort worth making. Lieutenant Colonel Johannes Drucker was one of the lucky ones who went out into space. He enjoyed being weightless. Some of the men in the Reich rocket force had to nurse their stomachs through every tour in orbit. Not Drucker. His problem was working hard enough on the exercise bicycle to keep from coming home a couple of kilos heavier than when he'd gone up. And the view from up here was beyond compare. Right now, his orbit was carrying him southeast across the United States toward the Gulf of Mexico. Through swirling clouds, he could see plains and forests, and coming up swiftly, the deep blue of the sea. And when he lifted his eyes to the stars blazing in the black sky of space, that was just as fine in a different way. But he couldn't gawp for long. His eyes flicked to the instruments that monitored oxygen, CO2, the batteries, literally the things that kept him breathing. Everything there was fine. And he'd used very little fuel from the maneuvering rockets so far this tour. He could change his orbit considerably if he had to. Then he was looking out the window again, this time to the sides and rear. Like its smaller predecessors, the A-45 was an army project, but the Focke-Wulf Design Bureau had given the manned upper stage a cockpit view a fighter pilot might have envied. He needed it. He depended far more on his own senses than did lizard pilots, who had fancier electronics to help them. Below and to either side were the bulges of his missile tubes, a thermonuclear sting in each of them. If he got the order, he could blow a couple of lizards or Russians or Americans out of the sky, or for that matter, aim the missiles at land targets. Sun sparkled off the titanium wings on which he'd ride back to Earth. The swastikas on the wings were due for repainting. This upper stage had made several landings since the last time they'd been slapped on. He shrugged. That sort of stuff was for people down on the ground to worry about. Up here, as in any combat assignment, what you did counted. What you looked like didn't. Drucker lightly touched the control stick. "Just a damn driver," he muttered. "That's all I've ever been, just a damn driver." He'd driven panzers against the French, against the Russians, and then against the lizards before setting his sights higher both figuratively and literally. This upper stage, he'd named it Käthe after his wife, responded far more smoothly and easily than the big grunting machines he'd formerly guided. Of course, if a shell slammed into a panzer, he had some chance of bailing out. If anyone ever decided to expend a missile on him here, odds were 1,000,000 to 1 he'd never know what hit him. His wireless set crackled to life. "German pilot, this is the U.S. tracking facility in Hot Springs. Do you read me? Over." A moment later, the American radio man switched from English to badly accented German. Like most who flew into space, Drucker spoke some English and Russian, and some of the lizard's language, along with his German. "Hot Springs tracking, this is the German rocket," he said. "How do I look, over?" It wasn't an academic question. By his own navigation, he was in the orbit calculated for him. If American radar showed otherwise, though, things might get sticky. Unexpected changes in course from a spacecraft carrying nuclear weapons had a way of making people nervous. But the American answered, "In the groove," which let him relax. Then the fellow said, "How's the weather up there, Hans? Over?"
"Very bad," Drucker answered seriously. "Rain last night, and a snowstorm ahead."
"Is that you, Joe? Over."
"Yeah, it's me," Joe said with a laugh at Drucker's attempt at humor. Weather was one thing, maybe the only thing, he didn't have to worry about in space.
"You'll be coming down from your tour in another few orbits, won't you? Over?"
"I do not answer this sort of question," Drucker said. "You know I do not answer this sort of question. Your pilots do not answer this sort of question when we ask. Over?"
"You stay nosy, though, and so do we," Joe answered, not in the least put out. "Have yourself a safe landing. I'll talk to you some more when you come up for another turn. Over and out."
"Thank you. Over and out," Drucker said.
The American signal had started to break up before strengthening. Like the Reich and the Soviet Union, the USA had strings of ships that relayed transmissions to pilots wherever above the Earth they might be. The lizards were the only ones who didn't need to bother with that. For one thing, they had more communications satellites and other spacecraft in orbit than all the human powers put together. For another, they had ground stations around the world, which no human power did. Drucker scowled, and now their colonization fleet was beginning to join the conquest fleet. The colonists had set out from Tau Ceti II about the time the conquest fleet reached Earth. They'd expected a world subdued and waiting for them. Hitler didn't let that happen, Drucker thought proudly. Could he have done so without harming the greater German Reich, he would have blasted every lizard spacecraft out of the sky. He couldn't. No human could. What would happen when the colonists started coming down to Earth was something he didn't like to think about. What would happen when he came back to Earth was less important to human history, but much more immediately urgent to him. Joe's "have yourself a safe landing" hadn't been idle chatter. The upper stage Drucker rode, like all man-made spacecraft, was an uneasy blend of human and lizard technology. The Wall of Heroes at Pienamunda had all too many names inscribed on it. Despite the handsome pension that would accrue to his widow, Drucker did not want his added to it. He slid over the Atlantic in a matter of minutes, and then across Africa. The whole continent belonged to the lizards. Some small rebellion still simmered in what had been the Union of South Africa, enough to keep the lizards from exploiting the minerals there as fully as they might have. Other than that, the whole great landmass was theirs to do with as they would. When his orbit swung north of the equator once more, he got a call from a Soviet radar station. The Russians also confirmed that he was where they expected him to be. His conversation with them, unlike the one with the American radio man, was coldly formal. He would have got rid of them too, could he only have done it safely, and he knew they felt the same way about him. He scowled again. If only the lizards hadn't come along when they did, the Reich would have put paid to Bolshevism once and for all. He couldn't do anything about that either. The world, when you got down to it, could be a pretty unsatisfactory place. An orbit and a half before he was supposed to land, he radioed a German relay ship and confirmed that he was coming back to Earth. He spoke in clear. Code made listeners nervous, and the lizards certainly were monitoring his transmissions. The Americans and Russians probably were, and the British and Japanese might be. A touch of a button fired the retarding rockets in the nose of his spacecraft. As soon as they had burned long enough to slow the craft and take him out of orbit, he shut them down. The touch of another button slid covers over the openings to their motors. He breathed easier when sensors confirmed all three covers were in place. A motor opening left unsealed would have wrecked his aerodynamics, his spacecraft, and him. As he slid back into the atmosphere, the nose of the craft and the leading edges of the wings glowed red. The ablative coating on them was a lizard invention that all three human nations that put men into space had stolen. Little by little, the stick came alive in Drucker's hands.
Before long, he was flying the upper stage like a large, heavy glider. Germany's Baltic coastline was anything but interesting, especially after so many of the earthly marvels he'd seen from space. Nothing but low, flat land sloping ever so gradually downward toward the gray, shallow sea. Another reassuring sound was that of the landing gear coming down. Drucker landed the upper stage on a long, concrete runway. After 2 weeks of weightlessness, he felt as if he had someone, or maybe two or three someones, sitting on his chest. Moving like an old, old man, he climbed out of the hatch set into the side of the spacecraft and down a little ladder to the runway. Having fire trucks standing by was normal. Having ground crew men jogging up to take charge of the upper stage was also normal. So was having the base commandant, a major general with the silver-gray Waffenfarbe of the rocket force, coming up to greet him. Having a couple of SS men in long black coats accompanying the general, though, was anything but normal. Drucker's eyes narrowed. His dislike for the SS went back almost half a lifetime to a day when he and other enlisted men of his panzer crew had cheated them of their chosen prey. No one he knew liked the SS. Everyone he knew feared the SS. He feared the SS himself, and feared the men in black the more because his past, if it ever came out, left him vulnerable to them even after all these years. As they came up to him, their right arm shot out and up in perfect unison. "Heil Himmler!" they chorused. "Heil!" Drucker returned the salute. He turned to Major General Dornberger, a decent enough fellow. "What's up, sir?" Before Dornberger could speak, one of the SS men said, "You are Drucker Johannes, Lieutenant Colonel, pay number..." He rattled it off. "I am." Drucker would much sooner not have been standing there. His feet hurt. His back hurt. Even his hair seemed to hurt. He wanted to go somewhere, sit down, or better yet, lie down and make his report. After riding a rocket into space, wasn't he entitled to a little comfort? A bottle of schnapps would have been nice, too. "Who are you?" he asked as cuttingly as he dared. The SS man ignored him. "You are to consider yourself removed from the roster of approved Reich Rocket Force pilots effective this date and pending investigation and interrogation," he droned. "What?" Drucker stared. "Why? What did I do? What in blazes could I have done? I have been out in space, in case you hadn't noticed." Inside, he shivered. Had his past risen up to bite him after all? "You will come with us immediately for interrogation and evaluation," the SS man said. "We have discovered reliable evidence that your wife's paternal grandmother was a Jew." Drucker's jaw fell open. Kata had never said a word about that, not in all the years he'd known her. He wondered if she'd known herself. "Come," the SS man snapped. Numbly, Drucker came. Mordecai Anilovich whistled as he rode a bicycle along a road not far from the border between lizard-occupied Poland and the greater German Reich. A farmer was weeding not far from the side of the road. Anilovich waved to him. "Have you stopped beating your wife, Boleslav?" he called. The Pole waved to him. "Devils will roast you in hell, you damn Jew." They both laughed. Anilovich kept pedaling up the road toward Łódź. If Poland wasn't the most peculiar country in the world, he couldn't imagine what was. Just for starters, it was the only place he could think of where most of the inhabitants were happier to have the lizards in charge than they would have been with human beings. Of course, given that the choices in human overlords were limited to the Reich and the Soviet Union, that made better sense in Poland than it did most other places. Oh, some Poles went on and on about regaining their independence. They fondly imagined they could keep that independence more than about 20 minutes if the lizards ever decided to leave.
They'd managed to keep it for 20 years after World War I, but both their big neighbors had been weak then. The USSR and, to Mordecai's regret, Germany weren't weak now. And the Jews who survived in Poland weren't weak these days either. Anilovich had a submachine gun slung across his back. A lot of men and even women, both Poles and Jews, still went armed these days. Mordecai had seen a lot of Westerns from Hollywood, some dubbed into Polish, others into Yiddish. He understood them much better now than he had when he'd been a Warsaw engineering student before the Germans invaded in 1939. A gun was an equalizer. Hidden away somewhere not too far from Łódź, the Jews had the ultimate equalizer, an explosive metal bomb captured from the Nazis who'd intended to turn the city and its large ghetto into a mushroom cloud. Anilovich didn't know whether the bomb would still work after all these years. His technicians had done their best to maintain it, but how good was that? The Poles couldn't be sure. Neither could the lizards, and neither could the Germans or the Russians. He started whistling again, a loud, cheery tune. "Not being too certain is good for people," he said to no one in particular. "It keeps them from going ahead and doing things they're sorry for later." As he got closer to Łódź, his legs started aching. He was up into his 40s now, not a young man as he had been during the war. He'd been riding a good long way, too, up from Bukatuf. But whenever he got aches and pains he didn't think he ought to have, he wondered if the nerve gas he'd breathed while keeping the Germans from blowing up Łódź was still having its way with him. He'd had the antidote. Without it, he would have just quietly stopped breathing and died. Even so, his health had never been the same since. That sort of doubt made him pedal harder than ever to prove to himself that he did have something left. Sweat streamed down his face. The modern suburbs around Łódź whizzed past in a blur. So did a lizard radar station, one dish scanning toward the west, toward Germany, the other toward the south in the direction of German-dominated Hungary. If trouble came this way, it could get here in a hurry. If trouble came this way and didn't get knocked down, he would probably die before he knew it arrived. That was a consolation of sorts, but he declined to be consoled. Most of the people in the neighborhood around the radar station were Jews. They waved to Mordecai as he rode past. He waved back and called out the same sort of insults he'd traded with Boleslav the Pole. Along with most of the Jews in Poland, he switched back and forth between Yiddish and Polish, sometimes hardly noticing he was doing it. Traffic got heavier as he rode up Franciszkanska Street into the city. Horse-drawn wagons, lorries, motor cars, some old gasoline burners, others hydrogen-powered, and swarms of bicycles. Anilovich was glad to have an excuse to slow down. New and old commingled inside Łódź. It had suffered in the German invasion, and again in the lizards' conquest of the area, and yet again when the Nazis started lobbing rockets at it. In the intervening years, fresh construction had replaced most of the buildings wrecked in one round or another of fighting. Some new structures were of brick or pale tan sandstone that harmonized with their older neighborhoods. Others, especially those the lizards had run up for themselves, were so boxy and utilitarian they might as well have been alien invaders, and so, in fact, they were. Anilovich still lived in what had been the Łódź ghetto, not far from the fire station that had housed the ghetto's only motorized vehicle, a fire engine. He could have lived anywhere in the city, indeed anywhere in Poland, he chose. His flat suited him well enough, and his wife, Berta, had lived her whole life in Łódź. He sometimes thought about moving, but without great urgency. An old friend waved as he rolled to a stop in front of the block of flats and put his feet down on the ground. Mordecai waved back. "How are you today, Ludmila?" he asked with real concern.
Ludmila Jaeger slowly walked up to him.
I am not so bad, she replied in Russian-accented Polish. How are you?
I'm pretty well, Anilovich answered in Yiddish.
Ludmila nodded. She spoke German and could follow the Jew's variation on it. He went on.
How are your legs? How are your arms?
She shrugged. The motion made pain flow across her round, ruddy face. With what looked like a deliberate effort of will, she wiped it away.
I will never move fast again, she said. Ничего.
That was a Russian word and a useful one. It meant something like, it can't be helped. Ludmila went on.
It could have been worse.
Pain filled her face again. This time she let it stay.
For Heinrich, it was worse.
I know, Anilovich said quietly and kicked at the cobblestones. A Jewish partisan leader, a German panzer officer who couldn't stomach the incineration of Łódź, and a Red Air Force pilot, as Ludmila had been then. A strange trio to thwart the Reich after the atomic bomb got smuggled into the city. They'd done it, but they'd paid the price. Mordecai Anilovich knew how lucky he'd been. All he had to show for his brush with Otto Skorzeny's nerve gas were pains if he exercised too hard for too long. Ludmila, though, was nearly a cripple. And Heinrich Jaeger. Mordecai shook his head. Jaeger, a German who proved his kind could be decent, had died young and with few healthy days before he died. After all these years, Anilovich still wondered why. Was it because Jaeger had been 20 years older than his two comrades? Or had he breathed in more of the gas? Or had the antidote not been so effective on him? No way to tell. No way at all. Whatever the reason, it was too damn bad. Ludmila might have been reading his thoughts. She said,
He did what he thought was right. If he hadn't done it, the fascist jackals might have caused the destruction of the entire world. We had a ceasefire with the lizards. If it had come apart then... Heinrich said to the end of his days that keeping that from happening was the best thing he ever did.
I wish you were still here to say it, your fascist jackal, Anilovich replied. Ludmila smiled. She still sometimes used communist jargon without even noticing she'd done it. She said,
So do I, but... Ничего.
Yes, that was a very useful word indeed. With another nod, she made her slow, painful way down the street, never once complaining. Anilovich carried the bicycle upstairs to his flat. Had he been so rash as to leave it on the sidewalk, even with a stout chain, it would have walked with Jesus. Even Jews used that saying about mysterious disappearances these days. When he opened the door, familiar chaos surrounded him. His wife, Berta, wearing a dress that would have been stylish in London a couple of years before and was still the height of fashion in Łódź, came up to give him a kiss. As always, a smile brought beauty to her plain face without the intermediate step of prettiness. She said something. It was probably, How are you? Or how are things? But Anilovich had trouble being sure. His daughter Miriam was practicing the violin. His son David, a couple of years younger, was practicing Hebrew for his bar mitzvah, which was only a little more than a month away. And his other son, Heinrich, who was 8, was working his way through a school lesson in the lizard's language. These days, Anilovich hardly noticed the contrast between Blessed art thou, O Lord, our God, King of the universe, and It shall be done, Superior Sir. He did notice the racket. He would have had to be deaf, or more likely dead, not to notice. The racket changed only languages when his children spotted him. They all tried to tell him everything about their days at the same time. What he heard were bits and pieces that surely didn't, couldn't have gone together. If a boy had, in fact, invited Miriam to go to a film about lizard irregular verbs, the world was even stranger than Anilovich suspected.
When his wife could get a word in edgewise, she said, "Bunim telephoned a couple of hours ago."
"Did he?"
That brought Mordecai to full alertness. Bunim was the most powerful lizard stationed in Woodj. What did he want?
"He wouldn't tell me,"
Berta answered.
"He said leaving a message would not be proper protocol."
"Sounds like a lizard," Anilovich said, and Berta nodded. He went on, "I'd better ring him up. Can you keep the menagerie down to low roars while I'm on the telephone?"
"I can try,"
his wife said, and proceeded to lay down the law in a fashion Moses might have envied. In the brief respite thus afforded, and he knew it would be brief, Mordecai went into his bedroom to use the telephone. He had no trouble getting through to Bunim. The regional sub-administrator always accepted calls from his phone code.
"I have a warning for you, Anilovich,"
he said without preamble. His German was fairly fluent. Hearing the Nazi's language in his mouth never failed to set Anilovich's teeth on edge.
"Go ahead," Anilovich answered, not showing what he felt. "A warning, yes," the lizard repeated. "If you Tosavites plan any interference against the anticipated arrival of colonists in this region, it will be suppressed without mercy."
"Regional sub-administrator, I know of no such plans inside Poland," Anilovich answered, on the whole truthfully. As he'd thought before, most of the human inhabitants of Poland, Jews and Poles alike, preferred their alien overlords to any of the humans who aspired to the job.
"Perhaps you should know more," Bunim said, and added an emphatic cough. "We have received a communication threatening that if 1 million males and females of the race colonize Poland, that entire 1 million shall die."
"First I've heard of it," Anilovich said, which was completely true. "Probably a lunatic. In what language was this communication? That may give you a clue."
"It gives no clue," Bunim said flatly. "It was in the language of the race."
Nesseref used her maneuvering thrusters to ease the shuttlecraft away from the outer skin of the 13th Emperor Makakap. She checked the shuttlecraft's instrument panel with special care. Like the ship with which it had come, it had just crossed a gulf of space even light would have needed more than 20 of the race's years to travel. Of course, the revived engineers had already been over the shuttlecraft again and again. That was how the race did things. But Nesseref was no more inclined than any other female or male to leave anything to chance. Everything seemed normal till she got to the radar display. With a hiss of surprise, she swung both eye turrets toward it, turning what had been a routine glance to a shocked state. A finger claw activated the radio link with the ship.
"Shuttlecraft to control," Nesseref said. "Shuttlecraft to control. I wish to report that the radar set is showing impossible clutter." "Control to shuttlecraft," a technician aboard the 13th Emperor Makakap replied. "Control to shuttlecraft. That clutter is not, repeat, is not impossible. We have a crowded neighborhood around Tosev 3 right now. The ships of the colonization fleet, the ships and satellites of the conquest fleet, and the ships and satellites of the Tosevites, the big uglies the males of the conquest fleet call them. Remember your briefing, shuttlecraft pilot."
"I remember," Nesseref answered. Things hadn't been as anticipated for the race, disorienting in and of itself. The conquest fleet had not conquered, or not completely. The Tosavites had proved improbably far advanced. Nesseref had believed what the briefing mail said. He wouldn't have lied to her, but she hadn't begun to think about what it meant. Now she was seeing that with her own eyes.
As she scanned more instruments, she discovered that radar frequencies the race did not use were striking the shuttlecraft. Any one of them might guide a missile on its way to her.
"Shuttlecraft to control," she said. "You can confirm that we are at peace with these Tosavites?"
"That is correct, shuttlecraft pilot," the controller said. "We are at peace with them, or at least no great fighting is going on right now. On advice from males of the Conquest fleet, we have relayed the time of your burn and your anticipated trajectory to the Tosavites and assured them we have no hostile intentions. The ones with whom I spoke used our language oddly, but understandably."
"I thank you, Control."
Nesareff did not want to speak to touchy, possibly hostile aliens, no matter how well they used the language of the race. As far as she was concerned, they had no business using radio and radar at all. That they had such things disrupted plans the race had made centuries before. Nesareff took it almost as a personal affront. Moments slid past. Nesareff spent them aligning the shuttlecraft with fussy precision. When the job was done, she waited till it was time to leave orbit. Her finger claw hovered above the manual override control in case the computer didn't begin the burn at the right time. That was most unlikely, but training held. Never take anything for granted. Deceleration slammed her back into her padded couch. It seemed to hit harder than she remembered, though all the instruments showed the burn to be completely normal. As the computer had begun it in the proper instant, so the machine shut it down when it should.
"Control to shuttlecraft," came the voice from the 13th Emperor Makakap. "Your trajectory is as it should be. I am instructed to recommend that you acknowledge any radio signals the Tosavites may direct toward you while you are descending from orbit."
"Acknowledged," Nesareff said. "It shall be done."
She wondered what things were coming to when the race had to treat with these Tosavites as if they held true power. But if they were out in space, they did hold some true power. And obedience had been drilled into her as thoroughly as into any other male or female of the race. Before long, that obedience paid off. The computer reported a signal on one of the race's standard communications frequencies. By its direction, it came from an island off the northwestern coast of the main continental mass. The computer indicated the race did not control that part of Tosev 3. Nesareff turned the receiver to the indicated frequency and listened.
"Shuttlecraft of the race, this is Belfast tracking," a voice said.
The accent was strange and mushy, unlike any she'd heard before.
"Shuttlecraft of the race, this is Belfast tracking. Please acknowledge."
"Acknowledging Belfast tracking."
Nesareff knew she'd made a hash of the Tosavite name, whatever it meant, but she couldn't do anything about that.
"Receiving you loud and clear."
"Thank you, shuttlecraft," the Tosavite down on the ground said. "Be advised your trajectory matches the flight plan your shiplord sent us. The Nazis will have nothing to complain about when you pass over their territory."
Nesareff neither knew nor cared what Nazis were. Whatever they were, they had a cursed lot of nerve presuming to complain about anything the race did. The big ugly from this Belfast tracking had his, she supposed it was a male, nerve too, for talking with her as if they were equals.
"Acknowledging," she repeated, not wanting to give him anything more than that.
Another Tosavite hailed her. He identified himself not as a Nazi, but as a tracker from the Greater German Reich. Nesareff wondered if the Tosavite back at Belfast had been trying to mislead her. As that first big ugly had predicted, though, this one did find her course acceptable.
"Do not deviate," he warned, his accent still mushy, but somehow different from that of the first big ugly with whom she'd spoken. "If you deviate, you will be destroyed without warning. Do you understand?"
"Acknowledged," Nesareff said tightly.
She was low in the atmosphere now, dropping down toward the speed of sound. If the Tosavites could build spacecraft, they could assuredly blow her out of the sky. But they would have no need.
I shall not deviate from my course. You had better not.
This big ugly sounded even more arrogant than the one with whom she'd spoken before. He went on,
and you had better not pay any attention to the lies the English will try to feed you. In no way are they to be trusted.
Acknowledged, Nesareff said yet again. Why were the Tosavites warning her about one another? The too brief briefing had spoken of their intra-species rivalries, but she'd paid little attention to those. She hadn't imagined they could matter to her. Maybe she'd been wrong. Then, to her vast relief, a familiar-sounding voice said,
Shuttlecraft of the 13th Emperor Makakap, this is Warsaw Control. Your trajectory is as it should be. You will be on the ground here shortly. Acknowledging Warsaw Control,
Nesareff said. The male's assessment agreed with that of her own computer. She brought the shuttlecraft toward the fully upright position so she could land it with its jet. As she did so, she studied the monitor's view of the world below. She'd descended enough to get a detailed view of it for the first time.
Warsaw Control, is it always so green here? It is, shuttlecraft pilot,
the male on the ground answered,
except during winter, and then it is white with frozen water falling out of the sky in flakes like shed skin. You would not believe how cold it can get here.
Nesareff wouldn't have believed the male at all had the briefing officer not also spoken of how beastly Tosef III's climate could be. She still found the landscape strange and unnatural. She was used to rocks and dirt with occasional vegetation, not the other way around. Now she would see buildings, too. Some the utilitarian cubes and blocks the race favored, others absurdly ornate. Why would anyone want to build like that, she wondered. She also spied small buildings roofed not with metal or concrete or even stone, but with what looked like dry grass. How could a species that used such primitive building materials fare off the surface of its planet? Being without a good answer, she eyed the instruments, once more ready to use manual override if the shuttlecraft's landing legs did not extend or if the rocket failed to ignite at the proper moment. No such emergency developed. Again, she had not expected one. But preparedness was never wasted. Flame splashed off the concrete of the landing area, then winked out as the computer cut off the rocket motor. The monitor showed people wheeling a landing ramp out toward the shuttlecraft so she could descend. No, they weren't people. They were Tosavites. They looked like the videos she'd studied, too erect, too large, draped in cloths to conserve body heat, even at what was evidently the warmer season of the year. Some of them had hair, it put her in mind of fungus, all over their blunt, round faces, others just on the top of the head. Next to the male of the race trotting along beside them, they put her in mind of poorly articulated toys for hatchlings. With a small clank, the top end of the ramp brushed the side of the shuttlecraft. Nesareff opened the outer door, then hissed as chilly air poured in. She hissed again when the air struck the scent receptors on her tongue. It stank of smoke and carried all sorts of other odors she'd never smelled before. She skittered down the ramp.
I greet you, superior female,
the male waiting at the bottom said. With an emphatic cough, he added,
Strange to see a new face in these parts instead of the same gang of males. Yes, I suppose it must be,
Nesareff said. Her eye turrets swiveled this way and that as she tried to take in as much of this part of this new world as she could.
But then, all of Tosev III is strange, isn't it?
That it is.
The male used another emphatic cough.
A big ugly, now, a big ugly would have said, good to see a new face, by the Emperor.
He cast down his eyes.
They really think that way.
Nesareff's shiver had only a little to do with the unpleasant weather.
Aliens, she said. How can you bear to live among them? It is not easy, the male replied. Some of us have even started thinking more the way they do than anybody straight from home would be able to imagine, I expect. We have had to. A lot of the ones who could not are dead. But Tosev 3 does have its compensations. There is Ginger, for instance.
What is Ginger? Nesareff asked. It hadn't been in the briefing.
Good stuff, the male said. I will give you a vial. You can take it back up with you when you fetch this intelligence data up into orbit. We do not want to transmit it even encrypted, for fear the big uglies will break the encryption. They have done it before and hurt us doing it. Are they really that bad?
Nesareff asked.
No, the male told her. Really, they are worse.
David Goldfarb minded being stationed in Belfast less than a lot of people might have. From what he'd seen, even men brought over from England soon tended to divide along religious lines, Protestants going up against Catholics in long-running arguments that sometimes turned into brawls. Being a Jew, he was immune to that sort of pressure. All things considered, Jews got on pretty well in Belfast. Each faction here despised the other so thoroughly it had little energy to waste on any other hatreds. Neither Catholics nor Protestants gave Naomi and the kids a hard time when they left the married officer's quarters to shop. Goldfarb's swivel chair creaked when he leaned back in it. First shuttlecraft from the colonization fleet we've tracked, he remarked.
That's right, Flight Lieutenant, Sergeant Jack McDowell answered. If the Scot disliked serving under a Jew who singularly lacked a cultured accent, he was veteran enough to conceal the fact.
Won't be the last, though.
No. Goldfarb was a veteran himself, having spent his entire adult life in the RAF.
Not the world we thought it would be, is it?
Not half it's not,
McDowell agreed sorrowfully. He pulled a packet of Chesterfields from his breast pocket, stuck one in his mouth, and lit it. Holding the packet out to Goldfarb, he asked,
Care for a fag, sir?
Thanks.
Goldfarb leaned forward to light the smoke from the one McDowell already had going. He took a drag, then blew a ragged smoke ring. After another drag, he sighed.
Doesn't taste like much, does it?
Too right it don't.
McDowell said, even more sorrowfully than before. He, too, sighed.
Not a Yank brand going that tastes like much. When you lit up a player's, by God, you knew you had a cigarette in your face.
That's the truth.
Goldfarb coughed in fond reminiscence.
It's the end of the Empire, that's what it is.
The phrase had taken on a mournful currency in Britain after the lizards occupied most of what once was the largest empire on the face of the earth. Cut off from much of the tobacco they'd used, British cigarette manufacturers had gone under one after another. McDowell's long, lean, ruddy face got even more sour than usual.
The end of the empire is. And do you know what's the worst of it?
He waited for Goldfarb to shake his head, then went on.
The worst of it, sir, is that the youngsters who've grown up since the bloody lizards came, they don't care. It doesn't matter to them that we're shoved back onto a couple of little islands. All they want to do is lay about and drink beer, you ask me.
They don't know any better, Goldfarb answered. This is what they're used to. They don't remember how things were. They don't remember how we kept the Nazis from invading us, and how we beat the lizards when they did.
Savagely, McDowell stubbed out his bland American cigarette and said, "And now we're on the dole from the Yanks and the Nazis both. Damned if I don't half wish the lizards had beaten us after all. Better to go down swinging than to slip into the muck an inch at a bloody time."
"Something to that," said Goldfarb, who despised the dependence on the greater German Reich into which a Briton shorn of her colonies had been forced. "I warned that shuttlecraft pilot about the Nazis. Haven't heard any squawks since, so I suppose he got down safe in Poland." McDowell leered. "That was a shuttlecraft from the colonization fleet. How do you know a lady lizard wasn't flying it?"
"I don't," Goldfarb admitted, blinking. "It never even occurred to me." He shrugged. "Doesn't matter much, not to me and not to the lizards either. If their females aren't in season, the males don't care about chasing skirt, poor buggers."
"I'd pay £5 to see a lady lizard in a skirt," McDowell said.
"Come to think of it, so would I," Goldfarb answered with a chuckle. He got to his feet and stretched. "Thanks for the smoke."
"Any time, Flight Lieutenant," McDowell said. "I've cadged more from you than you ever have from me."
Goldfarb shrugged again. A Jew who got a reputation for stinginess found himself in even more hot water these days than he would have a generation before. Britain didn't go in for the madnesses of the Reich over on the continent, but some of the Nazis' attitudes had rubbed off, especially down in England. That was another reason Goldfarb hadn't minded being posted to Northern Ireland. He walked out into the watery sunshine. Belfast seldom got any other sort. Parabolic radar dishes scanned every direction. They were ever so much smaller and ever so much more powerful than the sets he'd served during the Battle of Britain and during the Lizard's arrival, till the aliens knocked out those sets. Some of the improvement would surely have come over the course of time, regardless of whether the lizards landed on Earth. But captured equipment and training discs playable by what they called Skelkwonk light had kicked human technology far ahead of where it would have been otherwise. A couple of RAF officers strode past Goldfarb. He stiffened to attention and saluted. They both outranked him. One of them was saying, "Once they're all down, we'll pay back a lot of..." After returning Goldfarb's salute, the other spoke in an elegant Oxonian accent. "Now, now, old man, don't you know?" His gaze flicked across Goldfarb as if the flight lieutenant were a speck of lint on his lapel. Both officers fell silent till Goldfarb was out of earshot. He went on his way, quietly steaming. Far too many officers these days gave him the glove because he was Jewish. He couldn't do anything about it either, or rather he could, but anything he did was likely to make matters worse. Anti-Semitism kept wafting across the channel like a bad smell. That Heinrich Himmler seemed so calm and rational about it, rather than ranting as Hitler had done, only made it more appealing to the aristocratic Englishman of the stiff upper lip school. "What do they think?" Goldfarb muttered. "I should get down on my knees and thank them for the privilege of saving their bacon," an American phrase, to the point if not kosher, "from the lizards. Not bloody likely." Trouble was, too many of them did think exactly that. He knew his chances of making squadron leader were about as good as Britain's chances of retaking India from the lizards. If he hadn't had a record far better than those of his competitors, and if he hadn't had some blokes on his side back in the days when being on a Jew's side didn't take extraordinary moral courage, he never would have become an officer at all. He had become one, though. If those snooty brass hats didn't like it, too bad for them. He wondered what sort of conversation they'd judged unsuitable for his tender ears. He'd never know. He also wouldn't lose any sleep over it. Had he lost sleep over every slight, he'd have lain awake every night. People on the streets of Belfast kept an eye on him as he headed for his home. He didn't look like an Englishman or an Irishman or even a Scot.
His hair was too curly and the wrong shade of brown to boot, while his face bore a distinctly Judaic nose. Said nose itched. He scratched it. An itchy nose was supposed to be a sign he'd kiss a fool. When he got home, he planted a big smack on Naomi. Maybe she'd been a fool for marrying him all those years ago. Her family had got out of Germany while some Jews still could. His had fled Polish pogroms before World War I. But she hadn't looked down her own charming nose at him, and they remained as happy as two people could reasonably expect in this uncertain world. "What's new?" she asked, her English still faintly accented, though she'd been in Britain since her teens. He told her about the shuttlecraft from the colonization fleet and about the warning he'd been able to pass on. Then he sighed. "It won't do any good. The lizards in the colonization fleet don't know Nazis from necklaces." "You did what you could," Naomi said, and added an emphatic cough. Goldfarb laughed. "You caught that from our children," he said severely, "and they caught it from the wireless and the telly."
"And the wireless and the telly caught it from the lizards. Maybe we are becoming a part of their empire one bit at a time," his wife answered. "And speaking of such things, you have a letter from your cousin in Palestine."
"From Moishe?" Goldfarb said in glad surprise. "Haven't heard from him in a couple of months. What has he got to say?"
"I don't know. I haven't opened it," Naomi said.
That was standard practice in the Goldfarb household. No one ever opened mail addressed to someone else.
"Here, I'll get it for you."
He watched her go over to the sideboard, watched appreciatively as skirts were shorter this year, and plucked the letter from a cut glass dish there. She carried it back to him. It bore no stamp but an adhesive label covered with lizard squiggles. Moishe Russi had written Goldfarb's name and address in the Roman alphabet, but the letter inside the envelope was in Yiddish.
"Dear Cousin David," he wrote, "I hope this finds you well, as all are here in Jerusalem. Reuven has just finished exams for this term of medical school. How much more he knows of how the body works than I did at his age. He would have known more if the lizards had not come, of course, but he knows even more than he would have otherwise because they did. They understand life at a molecular level we were generations away from reaching."
So Naomi would understand, Goldfarb read the letter aloud. She had no trouble following spoken Yiddish, but could not fight her way through the Hebraic script in which it was written.
"Good that your cousin's son will be a doctor," she said.
"Yes," Goldfarb answered, thinking that the lizards had given medicine the same sort of lift they had electronics. He read on. "The Fleet Lord, you know, sometimes uses me as a channel between the race and people. This is one of those times. Something strange is going on in connection with the arrival of the colonization fleet. I do not know what it is. I do not know if he knows what it is. Whatever it is, it worries him." Goldfarb and his wife stared at each other. Anything that worried the Fleet Lord was liable to mean trouble for the whole human race and, incidentally, for the lizards. Why hadn't Moishe been more explicit? Because he didn't know much more himself, evidently.
"Finish," Naomi said.
"Atvar likes back-channel contacts more than he did some years ago," Goldfarb read. "If you can put a flea in the ear of some of your officer friends, it might do some good. Your cousin, Moishe."
"What will you do?" Naomi asked.
"God knows," Goldfarb answered. "I haven't got that many officer friends anymore, not with things like they are here, and I'm hardly the bloke to play at world politics."
Naomi looked at him. He let out a long sigh. He had no real choice and knew it. "I'll do what I can, of course."
Straha spent a lot of time touching up his body paint. He kept the complex patterns as neat as they had been back in the days when he commanded the 206th Emperor Yaur. He'd been the third-ranking male in the conquest fleet, behind only Atvar and Kirill.
He'd come within the breadth of a finger claw of toppling Atvar from Fleet Lord's rank. If he'd done it, if he'd taken charge of things in place of that boring plotter... He hissed softly.
Had the fleet been mine, Tosev III would belong to the race in its entirety, he said.
He believed that. From snout to tail stump, he believed it. It didn't matter. What might have been never mattered, save in the Big Ugly's overactive imaginations. A good male of the race, Straha kept his eye turrets aimed firmly at what had been and what was. Exile, he thought. When he failed to overthrow Atvar, the Fleet Lord's revenge had been as inevitable, as inexorable as gravity. It had also been slow, typical of Atvar, Straha thought with a sneer. Instead of waiting for it, Straha had taken the 206th Emperor Yaur's shuttlecraft and fled to the Big Uglies. Exile. The word tolled mournfully in his head, just as if it were reverberating from his hearing diaphragms. In exchange for his intimate knowledge of the race, the American Tosevites had treated him and continued to treat him as well as they knew how. Anything he asked for, they gave him. That was why he dwelt in Los Angeles these days, a climate not impossibly cold, not impossibly humid. Whenever he chose, he ate ham, which came close to a delicacy he'd known back on home. He had video gear purchased from the race, and electronic entertainments either purchased after the fighting or captured during it. Exile. When he wanted it, he even had the company of other males. But they were captives, not defectors. No one could blame them for collaborating with the Big Uglies. People could blame him. Could and did. However useful traitors were, no one loved them. That had proved as true among the Tosevites as it was among the race. Still, time had slipped past without too much unpleasantness till the colonization fleet came into Tosev's solar system. Very soon now, in the lands that the race ruled, it would set up a good facsimile of life on home, and Straha would be, the Big Uglies had a phrase for it, on the outside looking in.
I do not care, he said,
but that was a lie and he knew it. If he hadn't fled, he would have become a part of that life. Atvar would have degraded him, even arrested him, but would not have harmed him. Big Uglies sometimes enjoyed inflicting pain. The race didn't, and had had ever so much trouble understanding the difference.
Feeling pain. Now, when it came to feeling pain, the Tosevites and the race were very much alike.
Straha opened the drawer of a wooden cabinet of a size to suit Big Uglies better than males of the race, one with fixtures made for a Tosevite's hands. In the drawer, among other things, lay a well-sealed glass jar full of powdered ginger cured with lime, the race's favorite form of the herb. The American Big Uglies gave Straha all the ginger he wanted, too, though they were much less generous about letting their own leaders enjoy unlimited drugs. He poured some of the ginger onto the fine scales covering the palm of his hand, then raised it toward his mouth. Of itself, his tongue shot out. In a couple of quick licks, the ginger disappeared.
Ah! He hissed, a long sigh of pleasure.
When ginger first lifted him, he forgot he was all alone among barbarous aliens. No, that wasn't quite true. He remembered, but he no longer cared. With ginger coursing through him, he felt taller and stronger than any Big Ugly, and more clever than all the Big Uglies and all the other males of the race on Tosev III. Ideas filled his long, narrow head, each of them so brilliant it dazzled him before he could fully grasp it. He knew ginger only seemed to turn him tall and strong and brilliant. It didn't actually make him any of those things. Males who acted as if what the ginger told them were true had a way of dying before their time.
That was one reason he tried to keep his tasting within the bounds of moderation. Descending from ecstasy was the other reason. He had not felt so low going down from the 206th Emperor Yaur to the surface of Tosev III as he did when the drug's exaltation began to leach out of him. The harder he tried to grasp it, the more readily it slipped through his fingers. At last, it was all gone, leaving him lower than he had been before he tasted, and painfully aware of how low that was. Sometimes, to hold the crushing depression at bay, he would taste again when the first one wore off, or even for a third time on the heels of the second. But the herb-fueled exhilaration ebbed from one taste to another right after it, while the post-tasting gloom only got worse. Unlimited ginger, however much a taster might crave such a thing, did not mean unlimited happiness. And so, instead of taking a second taste, Straha put the ginger jar back in the drawer and slammed it shut. He picked up the telephone. Like the cabinet, it was of Tosavite manufacture, the handset made with the distance between a big ugly's mouth and absurd external ear in mind, the holes in the dial designed for blunt, clawless Tosavite fingers. Those holes served his finger claws well enough. The clicks and squawks of the electronics as the call went through were partly familiar, partly strange. The bell at the other end of the line was a purely Tosavite conceit. The race would have used some sort of hiss instead. Hello? The voice on the other end was Tosavite too, the greeting the one the local big uglies used among themselves on the telephone. Strassa had picked up some English during his long years of exile, but big uglies who wished to speak with him commonly used the language of the race. Straha used his own language now.
I greet you, Major Jaeger.
I greet you, Shiplord, Jaeger replied, dropping English without the least hesitation. Of all the Tosavites Straha had met, he came closest to being able to think like a male of the race. His question was very much to the point. Feeling lonely tonight?
Yes.
Straha choked back an emphatic cough. His hands folded into fists so that finger claws dug into his palms. Most big uglies would not have noticed what he hadn't quite said. Jaeger was different. Jaeger heard what wasn't said as well as what was. We have known each other a long time now, Shiplord, the Tosavite said. I remember thinking even in the early days, when your folk and mine were still fighting, how hard a road you had chosen for yourself.
You thought further ahead than I was thinking when I left the conquest fleet,
Straha said.
I get an itch under the scales admitting such a thing to a Tosavite, but it is truth.
The race had got where it was by planning ahead, by always thinking of the long term. Straha hadn't done that. He'd been paying ever since for not doing it. Exile. As if to rub that in, Jaeger said, You always did think more like a big ugly than most other males of the race I have known. He used the race's slang name for his kind without taking it as an insult, the way some Tosavites did.
I do not think like a big ugly,
Straha said with dignity.
I do not wish to think like a big ugly. I am a male of the race. It is merely that I am not a reactionary male of the race, as so many officers of the conquest fleet proved to be.
Venting his anger at Atvar and Kirill to a big ugly was demeaning, a telling measure of just how lonely he'd become. But he couldn't help it. Jaeger let out a few barks of noisy Tosavite laughter. I did not say you thought like a Tosavite, Shiplord. If you were one of us, you would be a hopeless reactionary. Even so, that makes you a radical among the race.
Truth, Straha said. You understand us well. How did this happen?
I know of your attachment to the wild literature your kind produced before the conquest fleet arrived, but others were attached to this literature too, and they have not your skill in dealing with the race.
In fact, shiplord, some of our best males and females for dealing with your folk were science fiction readers before the conquest fleet came, Jaeger replied, the key term necessarily being in English. But I count myself lucky. I could not have stayed a paid athlete much longer, and I do not know what I would have done after that. When the conquest fleet came, it let me discover I was good at something I had not known I could do at all. Is that not strange?
For the race, it would be surpassingly strange, Straha answered. For you Tosevites, I doubt it. So much of everything you do seems built around lucky accidents. But not all accidents are lucky. If we had come 200 years later, 100 of your years, I mean, we might have found this planet dead because of nuclear war.
It could be so, shiplord, Jaeger said. We can never know, but it could be so. But if you had waited a little longer than that, we might have come to home before you ever got to Tosev 3. Straha hissed in horror. Big Uglies played the game of what might have been far more naturally, far more fluidly than did the race. Straha tried to imagine a conquest fleet full of bloodthirsty Tosevites descending on calm, peaceful home. Save for conquests of other species, the race had not fought a war in more than 100,000 years. Except when a conquest fleet was a building, no military hardware above the level the police needed even existed. The Big Uglies would have had an easy time of it. He did not say that for fear of giving Jaeger ideas, not that any Big Ugly needed help coming up with ideas. What the exiled shiplord did say was,
"One day Big Uglies will visit home. One day, Big Uglies will bow before the Emperor."
In spite of having abandoned the race, Straha cast down his eyes at speaking of his sovereign.
"I wish I could visit your planet," Jaeger said. "We Tosevites aren't very good at bowing to anyone, though. You may have noticed that." "Snout counting," Straha said disparagingly. "How you think to rule yourselves through snout counting?"
Nictitating membranes slid across his eyes, a sure sign he was growing sleepy.
"I thank you for your time, Major Jaeger. I shall rest now."
"Rest well, shiplord," the Tosevite said.
"I shall."
Straha hung up. But even if he did rest well, tomorrow would be another day alone. 3. Under the summer sun, Jerusalem glowed golden. The local sandstone from which so much of the city was built looked far more impressive than the world's usual run of gray rocks. So Reuven Roussi thought, at any rate. Even marble would only have been silver to sandstone's gold. Jerusalem was Reuven's city, and he loved it with the uncritical, unquestioning adoration he'd lavished, for a little while, on the first girl with whom he'd become infatuated. His childhood memories of other towns, Warsaw, London, were filled with fear and hunger and cold. His eyes went to the Temple Mount, with the Dome of the Rock and the Western Wall. When had snow last fallen there? Not for many years, nor was it likely to fall again for many more. He did not miss it. He had almost a lizard's love for heat. But thinking of the lizards made him think of the marvelous antiquities on the Temple Mount in a different light. The Dome of the Rock dated from the 7th century of the Common Era. The Western Wall, of course, was far older, having gone up before Jesus strode along the streets on which Reuven walked now.
Archaeologists would be working in Jerusalem for centuries to come, piecing together the distant past. But that past seemed less distant to Reuven Russi than it did to his father Moisha, and far less distant than it would have to the grandfather he did not remember. His grandfather had never known the lizards. His father had been a grown man when they came, and thought of the earlier days as the normal state of mankind. To those Reuven's age and younger, especially in lands where the lizards ruled, they were simply part of the landscape. One of them skittered past him, intent on some business.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.